Good evening. Good evening. Welcome to the December 11th, 2017 Cape Elizabeth Town Council regular meeting. We're going to start off tonight with the oaths of office for the elected officials who were elected on November 7th. So turn over to Deb to administer the oath of office.
Thank you very much. I'd like to invite the councilors-elect to join me. Once you take the oath, I do have your oath for you to sign, and then I would ask the school board members-elect to join me after we're done with the councilors. Thank you.
Raise your right hand and repeat after me. I solemnly swear. That I support the Constitution. And will obey the laws of the United States. And of the state of Maine. That I will in all respects. Observe the provisions of the Charter. And ordinances of the Town of Cape Elizabeth. And statutes of the state of Maine. And will faithfully discharge. The duties incumbent upon me. As a member of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. And members elect the school board, please. Mr. Roberts is here.
Do we know?
You raise your hand, repeat after me. I solemnly swear. That I will support the Constitution. And will obey the laws of the United States. And of the state of Maine. That I will in all respects. Observe the provisions of the Charter. And ordinances of the Town of Cape Elizabeth. And statutes of the state of Maine. And will faithfully discharge. The duties incumbent upon me. As a member of the Cape Elizabeth School Board. Congratulations.
Thank you, Deb, and congratulations to all the newly installed officials. With that, could we please have the roll call?
Councilor Garvin.
Here.
Councilor Caitlin Jordan.
Here.
Councilor Penelope Jordan.
Here.
Councilor Lennon.
Here.
Councilor Randall.
Here.
Councilor Straw.
Here.
And Councilor Sullivan.
Here.
Thank you very much. Would you all please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance?
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
First up on our agenda is item number 1-2018, the election of the Town Council Chair. Council met in caucus last month, and it is the recommendation of the caucus to elect Jessica Sullivan as chair. We're looking for a motion.
So moved.
Councilor Straw, is there a second?
I'll second that.
Councilor Penny Jordan, any discussion? All those, oh, go ahead.
I just wanted to make a few brief comments, and I promise I won't be making comments regarding all the appointments. As a citizen in the past, I know I've been frustrated with the caucus process, how it does happen off the camera, and everyone just shows up, and the votes happen, and everything moves on through the system. And I just did want to touch on one aspect of the forecaster's reporting with respect to the caucus. First off, I'm very happy that the forecaster was there. It is a public meeting. I'm glad that they provided insight into what had occurred at that meeting. And the key point that I wanted to focus on was Councilor Penny Jordan and how she dealt with some issues at the meeting. Basically, she demonstrated a skill set that I personally know I'm lacking that I think was very valuable, and that she brought us together in a festivus airing of grievances, so to speak, that did allow, I think, she recognized that having us discuss the issues that had happened in the past, not in any way deciding any of these issues, just but the airing of the grievances that had occurred, getting it out there in the open, allowing the various councilors to address those issues so that we could move forward in a cooperative and collaborative manner. And I just wanted to thank Penny for that. And then I also wanted to say that Jessica Sullivan, or Councillor Sullivan, I haven't always agreed with her policy issues in the past, but she has never given me any reason to question her integrity. And for that reason, I am going to be supporting you for the chair. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any other discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor of the election of Jessica Sullivan as chair for 2018? Opposed? Motion's unanimous. Congratulations, Councilor Sullivan.
Thank the council for its support, and I look forward to a productive year for the council and also for the town of Cape Elizabeth. It's now time to recognize outgoing Chairman Jamie Garvin. So I have a few prepared words I'd like to say, and after I say them, I will open the floor to the rest of the council if they would like to add to my comments. On behalf of the council, I'd like to thank Jamie Garvin for his service as chairman this year. Jamie was tapped to be chairman after serving only 1 year as a councilor. His measured approach to issues caught the attention of council members, and he was enthusiastically supported in his new role. Jamie's very first challenge as chairman was a rather daunting task, and it was to lead the council in something that he hadn't done in 38 years. A search for a new town manager. Jamie successfully guided us through that process, which included interviewing candidates from as far away as Colorado. You all know the results. They're sitting to my immediate left. Throughout 2017, Jamie continued to study the issues and search for equitable solutions as he worked with the council and our new town manager, Matt Sturgis. In this and all things, his measured approach and attention to details has served us well in all of our efforts. Thank you, Jamie.
Thank you very much.
We have a gift, and which I'd like to give Jamie right now, and then if any other counselors would like to say something, now is the time. Anyone else? Penny? Councilor Penny Jordan?
Jamie, I really appreciated your leadership through the 2017 year. And as I thought about it, I reflected on that whole year. And like Jessica said, your measured ways of attacking issues that were in front of us and dealing with some really challenging ones, and your ability to really facilitate this group through open discussions. And what I saw, I think, were more open discussions than I had seen councils do in the past. But what I'm looking most forward to is working with you in your new role as that person sitting in that seat, because I think we'll get the benefits, even more benefits, of your thoughts and ideas. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay. All right. Let's move on. Item number two, conflict of interest, spouses serving on the town council and school board simultaneously.
Madam Chair, point of parliamentary inquiry, as this is my first meeting and I have not received any official training, I don't see the town attorney here, so I'm going to be flying a little blind here. My understanding is if an issue arises where I have a conflict of interest, is it correct that I need to immediately, when the item arises, raise the potential conflict? Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay, thank you. And then my understanding is that if there is a question as to whether a member has a conflict, that member then does not participate in the discussion and the vote with respect to the conflict. Is that correct?
That's my understanding.
Thank you. And would you, so last question of parliamentary inquiry. Would your understanding of the rule be that I should remove myself from the board during the discussion, and to the extent there are any questions with respect to me, that I address them at the podium?
Yes.
Thank you. With that, point of order, I believe I probably have a conflict with respect to this item.
Thank you. And
So my understanding is first you'll decide whether I have a conflict with respect to participation in this item, and then you will substantively discuss it. Is that correct?
Could you repeat that, please?
I apologize. Point of parliamentary inquiry. My understanding is that the group will first discuss whether I have a conflict, because I cannot recuse myself on my own. Instead, the group must decide whether I am recused. Once that decision is made, then the discussion of the substance will occur while I sit in the audience. Is that correct?
If I'm following you correctly, my understanding is that you bring this up as a point of order. You have a concern that you may have a conflict of interest. I ask for the council's agreement that you in fact may have a conflict of interest. I think the council affirms or does not. At that point, you take a seat in the audience and we continue our discussion. Yep.
With one point of clarification, are you specifically asking about a conflict relating to the serving of a school board member and a chair as a council member, or are you asking about, because there were two questions, the second one was being related specifically to the voting on the budget later on in the year?
I'm referring in the abstract right now, how do I proceed so that I proceed properly under these rules? If I have an issue in the abstract, if an item arises where I potentially have a conflict, how am I supposed to proceed under the rules? Because I haven't had proper training or guidance, and we don't have the town attorney here to give me guidance. I'm seeking your guidance as to what you understand the rules to be. Thank you.
Well, then I think what happens at this point is you have raised this as a point of order. I then ask for a motion to consider whether Councillor Straw has a conflict of interest. And what I would do is I would separate the two issues. First, whether you may serve at all, because you have raised that yourself. Mm-hmm. And second, with respect to deliberating on the school budget. Mm-hmm. So in the first, did you have a comment?
Keep going, it's fine.
Okay.
In point of parliamentary inquiry, my understanding is it doesn't require a motion, it's mandatory that the vote occur. Under our
okay.
rules, it is mandatory that the vote occur.
Okay.
If it is raised, the vote must occur. At least, am I correct mm-hmm. with that?
Yeah.
Thank you.
You certainly may be. And
I just want to clarify, we have two separate conflict rules and policies. First, you can raise the two, you know, the whole thing that we're going to go by today, that we know the person, that we may have it involved, that you're raising the issue. And then there's the request for a recusal. So I think we might be forgetting that part. You want to see if you need to be recused from this, not just that you...
No, I do not. I am not requesting that I be recused. Not at all. Not in the least bit. What I have pointed out is I potentially have a conflict. That Now the question is, what procedure do we properly follow when someone has a conflict? I have not asked to be recused.
That's okay.
Council Lennon, did you have your...
It was my understanding that unless you formally ask to be recused, at which point we'd then take a vote, if you're simply pointing out a possible snag or conflict or maybe potential conflict, that just triggers a conversation. And that's what I believe you're asking.
So, point of parliamentary inquiry. My understanding of the rules are as follows. The council member shall briefly explain their reason why they believe they may have a conflict of interest. The balance of the town council members after reviewing applicable statutes shall by majority vote determine if the member has a conflict. Shall. Not may, might, but shall.
Mm-hmm. Well.
Councilor Stoll, just one quick question. Are you asking if you have a specific conflict of interest or... Do you have any specific area that you'd like to discuss first to see if you do have a conflict and then testing it against the council? Or
thank you for the question. My question is a member of parliamentary inquiry. This item clearly pertains to me.
Exactly.
The question is, what is the proper procedure that we must follow when an item arises where a member potentially has a conflict? And I'm new. I do not know the procedure. I would like to follow the procedure. I'm looking to establish the procedure so that it's clear, that we all know, and that we have a framework that we as a group can follow going forward when conflicts arise.
It's the item that he's talking about.
Yes, the item specifically. And then before we get any further past the second block, so to speak, so you're looking at the first.
Right.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
I'm just beginning with we need a framework for dealing with the conflict. I want to make sure we are all on the same page with respect to what that conflict is. I realize a number of you have been town councilors in the past and have attested that you understand these rules. I'm looking for your guidance as to how to understand them, as I don't see the town attorney here to explain it to me.
So the question for the council would be...
I think what Chris is... Because this whole item deals with him specifically. Mm-hmm. And so, therefore, does he sit at the table and have the dialogue with us? Or do we say, Chris, we would like a recusal at this point in time because we're going to discuss this topic because it pertains to you. And I don't see how he can have the conversation about a decision that was brought forth by the town attorney. We're the ones who are reading it. We're the ones who are interpreting it. We're the ones who are discussing it. So go ahead, Caitlin.
I'm going to ask that we vote to recuse Chris Straw from the first item on the agenda.
Yeah. Make a motion.
My motion is that we...
Excuse me. Could councilors please speak through the chair?
Rephrase?
Hang on just a moment. So
she didn't want you to call on me.
No, that's not it.
That's okay. Sorry, Jessica.
Yeah. So could you rephrase your question through the chair?
So basically what I'm saying is what I hear Chris saying is that this item pertains to him 100%. Mm-hmm. And so therefore, I would put forth that we ask Chris to recuse himself as we deliberate this item.
Thank you.
That would be my motion.
And that's your motion. Is there a second?
Are you asking that Chris recuse himself or that we make a motion that we recuse Chris? Because he said he's not recusing himself.
I'm sorry, I worded it incorrect. Sorry, Jessica, I worded it incorrect.
All right. Then I would second that if... Are these new mics?
Yes.
Okay, they're not good.
I'm trying to
get
better.
I second your motion.
All right. Discussion. Council Lennon?
I think we need a formal motion that asks Chris to recuse, that asks the council to recuse Chris, because he just said he doesn't want to recuse himself. So I think we need to rephrase the motion to make sure it's perfect.
Point of clarification, I'm not saying I'm not recusing myself.
Councilor Starr, you have not been recognized by the chair. So I'm just trying to not let a meeting get, you know, out of control. And we're at a confusing point here. So I'd like to just proceed very carefully, if you don't mind. Thank you. So Councilor Jordan made a motion. Councilor Caitlin Jordan seconded it. Would you like to, I think we could amend, would you like to amend your original motion? Are we able to do that at this point?
A friendly amendment.
A friendly amendment?
Counselor? I think Penny amended it before I seconded her motion. Deb's got that.
Okay. So would the amended
motion
be read, please?
It's just the motion.
Counselor Penelope Jordan made a motion to recuse Counselor Straw from discussion and voting on item number 2. That was seconded by Counselor Caitlin Jordan.
Okay. So now we can proceed with our discussion on item number 2.
Did we vote?
Well, we have a motion, a seconded motion, so we can now have discussion. If you would like to discuss it any further, if you're ready to vote, is there anyone that would like any more comments? Okay. All those in favor of the motion? It's unanimous. Okay. So now we can proceed with our discussion on item number 2.
Okay.
Is anyone ready?
Would you like me to tee it up some?
Yeah. Let's let the town manager tee this up a little bit first. For the audience at home, you know, this issue has been addressed by the town's attorney, so our town manager is going to give us some information on that communication.
Thank you, Ms. Chair. The question was placed to me by Mr. Straw back on November 8th to inquire, because we are in uncharted waters as far as the town of Cape Elizabeth goes, as far as having a spouse on the school board as well as on the council at the same time. So the first question was asked if there was anything within the town charter that would disqualify either person from being or serving on either board. Our town's attorney investigated that and came back with the answer that actually there is no prohibition that is out there to state that neither Mr. Straw or Mrs. Straw could serve, and there is no conflict that exists there. So we pass go on that one, so they do not believe that there is a conflict that exists there. The second question that was asked was if a person is not disqualified for the above reason or to serve on either board, could Mr. Straw, in this case, participate in deliberations and vote with the town council when presented with the annual school budget? And Attorney Leahy thought that was less clear cut. He doesn't believe that the situation creates a true pecuniary conflict of interest, meaning that Mr. Straw won't gain any financial benefit from doing that, nor would Mrs. Straw. But the question is, would participating in those deliberations and then voting on accepting or rejecting the presented school budget be seen by others as having the appearance of a conflict? And that one would come ultimately down to the judgment of the council to decide. Would council members, for example, those opposed to a presented school budget, feel that he voted for the school budget because his spouse had vocally advocated in support of the budget, or due to her influence over him as a spouse, which is a reasonable question to ask for any of us. They're not saying that he would necessarily have a conflict of interest, but or be biased in that situation, but recommend that ultimately that if it would be up to Mr. Straw to disclose that, raise that question to the council at that point in time, and then let the council deliberate and decide if Mr. Straw could go forward or if they felt that he had a conflict and needed to be recused. If that explains it as well as we can, but that's pretty much the crux of the issue, and that's the first part, I guess. Question one is the one that you may want to, we needed the answer to go forward with from the beginning. Question two is something that you may want to consider in the background and think about as we encounter the budget deliberation session of the year. So as far as the timing of that goes, the council may have the ability to wait until you get into the budget season to discuss that, but it's something that you may want to consider for some time, because the budget isn't on our plate tonight as an item to be voted on for the council.
So with the Councilor?
Are we going to take the two items separately, Jessica?
Well, I was going to suggest that we take them as two separate items. First, the first one answering the question, is a person disqualified to serve as a member of the town council if the person's spouse simultaneously serves on the Cape Elizabeth School Board? I see that as the first question. Are we all in agreement that that's the first question? Is there any discussion on that question?
Yep. Okay, well, are we going to vote on these questions or are we just going to discuss them? Do you want a motion?
I'll entertain a motion.
I move that we follow the advice of the town attorney that there's no clear disqualification for a town council member to serve at the same time as a spouse on the school board.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Okay, any more discussion on that point? Councilor Garvin?
I'm just not sure why this needs a motion, to be quite honest, or why a vote needs to be taken. We've gotten guidance from legal counsel. The question seems to have been clarified as it relates to this particular item. There's no conflict with Councilor Strauss serving, so I'm not sure that it requires a vote of the council for that. The second item, as Matt pointed out, would seem to be more pertinent at the time at which we approach any decisions around the budget, which we're not doing tonight. So I'm just not sure why we need a motion and a vote tonight on this.
Okay. Are there any other thoughts on that? Councilor Lennon?
I agree with Jamie. When Jim Walsh served, his wife was a teacher in the school, and we would discuss it almost right before we voted on the budget. And my recollection is some years he recused himself and some years he didn't. So I may be misremembering that, but I do remember that he would bring it up the night of the vote. We could do it sooner, but I do sort of agree that maybe it should be more temporally related.
Okay. Any other thoughts? Caitlin?
If you want a motion to move this item forward and put it behind us, would we just make a motion that we've received the letter from the attorney and we will proceed in such a manner?
As advised,
yeah. And then how we recognize receipt of reports or correspondence or, something in that manner.
All right, so we have a motion and a second on the table.
Well, I guess I withdraw my motion.
You withdraw your motion. Well, it was originally... was it your motion originally? Okay. So you've withdrawn your motion.
Do you want a new one?
Yes, please.
I now move that we recognize that we received advice of counsel and we will proceed accordingly.
Second that.
All right. Any further discussion? So the consensus of the council is that we have received the advice of the town attorney on whether or not a member of the town council can simultaneously serve with a spouse on the school board. The council's happy to accept the advice of the town attorney, which is that he is qualified to do that, and that we will consider the second part of the concern at school budget time. Everybody else?
As advised by council.
Yeah. All right. So I don't think if we're not going to vote, we're going to just...
No, we are.
We have to move the motion.
Yep.
For that.
Okay. Yep. Receipt.
Okay, so that was your motion. New motion. Is there a second? We seconded it, right? Okay. All right. All those in favor?
Welcome right. back, Chris.
Thank you.
Come on up.
Okay.
Wasn't that a fun half hour?
Town Council reports and correspondence. Are there any reports and correspondence from the town councilors? Councilor Garvin?
On behalf of the Spurwink School Reuse Committee, I will report that, though I need to connect with Deb on securing a room for next week, we are due to meet next Monday evening, December 18th, at 7 o'clock, likely here at one of the rooms at Town Hall. Our expected agenda that evening will be to review and hopefully finalize a draft of our recommendation that will be coming back to the council pursuant to our extended deadline of December 31st. So it'll probably appear on the January agenda, January, February. So Deb, I'll work with you to set up a room this week. Thanks.
All right. Thank you. Anyone else? Penny?
I just wanted to remind everybody that the work around the comprehensive plan is going on, and we've had some wonderful, wonderful discussions on our online forum. I would impress on people to go out to the Cape Elizabeth website and go to Hot Topics Comprehensive Plan. The question this week is about transportation. There's a transportation section, and it really gets into modes of transportation, our roads, our connectors, sidewalks, and all of those types of things around our transportation network here in town. So the more dialogue we have, the better comprehensive plan we'll have. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, moving on, the Finance Committee report. As the outgoing Finance Chair, you all have your dashboard in front of you, and I will ask the Town Manager to give us the highlights on our financial dashboard as of December 1st this year.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I have some good news, I would say. Looking at our dashboard, we're tracking very well in the majority of all of our revenues and our expenditures. Specific of note, it would be under excise taxes. We continue to show robust movement when it comes to excise revenues, tracking greater than last year by greater than $22,700 above where we were at this point, which is positive development. Also, our building permits. Last year, we were doing colossal business from a building status. We are tracking similarly this year as well. We're currently at 75% of anticipated revenues, which is showing, I guess, a testament to a very healthy building climate within Cape Elizabeth at this point in time. Our sewer fees as well are doing well as well. No Portland Headlight gift shop sales are $51,600 above where we were at this point last year. So. That would come in part to a lot of good hard work by volunteers and by Gene Gross down at the gift shop. The one area that I have some concern about is regarding legal services, but this has been an atypical year when it comes to some of our legal expenditures. It's primarily due to some litigation that we've had ongoing with the Zoning Board of Appeals and some Planning Board work, as well as some other areas that we've been working on, but I will still be monitoring that as we go forward. But overall, the financial health of the town looks very strong, so we are in good shape. And previews are coming attraction. If you're looking for something to do in January, we will be having a workshop before the council meeting in January regarding the audit. So fasten your seatbelts. This would be good.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Just one request. Going forward, in addition to the financial dashboard, there's the more detailed document that's provided. It's provided in scanned PDF format. It makes it somewhat cumbersome to deal with, if at all possible. I don't know if it's technically possible with the way you have things set up. If we could receive that in true electronic PDF format, such that the text is OCR and so on and so forth. Thank you.
If you don't mind me asking, but I'm a bit of a luddite when it comes to that part of it. Not as a PDF, but as...
So what's happening now is the PDF, it appears the original document has been printed out into paper and then scanned back in.
Okay.
Which makes it images as opposed to, like, text.
Okay, yeah. I guess. I'll look into that and see if we can print a PDF type
yes.
item. Yeah, like, that's what I do with my dashboard, so
thank you.
I get you. Thanks.
Okay. Anything else on financial report?
No. That would be it.
Okay.
Thank you.
All right. Now we have come to the item, the opportunity for citizens to come and speak to the council on something that is not on tonight's agenda. Does anyone wish to speak on something that is not on tonight's agenda? Please come forward to the podium and give us your name and address.
Chris McCarthy, 9 Salisbury Lane. I want to thank the new board members for taking on such a hard job and thank the board for all that you do. I want to talk about a vote that took place the last meeting regarding plastic bags. I am glad that the town council decided to move forward with the motion that you did, but I was really disappointed. I think that given the information that was received. It was really disappointing that we didn't just go all the way forward and go ahead and approve this for all businesses. It's very obvious that this is good for society, for our town, and it was quite obvious there's enough data that this 5-cent fee changes people's behavior. We've got enough information locally from Portland, South Portland, and all over the nation. And I'd like to see us be a little more progressive. So I would encourage the current town council to take a mulligan and revote that and correct it. Thank you.
Thank you. No one else. Okay. And now for the town manager's monthly report, please.
Thank you very much. I'd like to start off by saying happy holidays to all Cape Elizabeth residents. The season is truly upon us, and the new year is just around the corner. One of the lovely items that signify the season is the placement of holiday wreaths on the town buildings. And I would like to say a huge thank you to the Cape Elizabeth Garden Club for providing those annually. They are lovely, and they complement our buildings extremely well. I do have some sad news to report for a great loss to the community with the passing of Sherry Gower, who passed away a week and a half ago. Sherry volunteered in many capacities for the town and since 1986, and she has been our elections warden since 2004. She will be missed and by staff and citizens alike, a great loss. Recently, we had a couple of off-leash aggressive dog incidents at the Gullcrest parcel. In following up on these incidents, I was speaking with Chief Williams, and a review of the ordinance indicates that the legal off-leash areas in town, as designated by the ordinance, are at Fort Williams, Lions Field, except the ball field, and the Poor Farm parcel on Spurwink across from the wastewater treatment facility. I'd like to please advise and remind people that the Gullcrest parcel is an on-leash area, and Public Works will be erecting signs reminding patrons of this shortly. To Mr. McCarthy's point, I have a quick update regarding the plastic bags and polystyrene. I did, right shortly after the council vote last month, sent out a letter to all the affected businesses that we knew of and let them know of the conversion by December 6th. Some of them I know will take a little bit of time to get up to speed and getting all, what they had for existing stock through, but I did speak with a number of them as well in following up, and they're moving forward, and I want to say a huge thanks to the Recycling Committee for going out and doing that outreach before, because by the time I reached out to them again, they were fully up to speed and weren't surprised. And I was at Cumberland Farms this evening before the meeting and noticed that they have successfully converted to non-polystyrene cups, so my field research has verified at least one compliant company. Also, as the year comes to a close, a reminder that please renew your dog license at the clerk's office. Those will be available to do that now, but January 1st, they come due. And finally, a huge thank you as the season begins to our Public Works Department for clearing the streets as the winter season began on Saturday night. And one last thing, 10 days from now, the days start getting longer. So that is manager's report this evening, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Thank you. Any comments on the manager's report? Okay. Next item is review of the draft minutes of the November 6, 2017 Town Council meeting. Do I have a motion to approve the draft minutes of the November 6, 2017 meeting?
So
Councilor Lennon?
So moved.
Is there a second? Councilor Caitlin Jordan? Any discussion? All those in favor? You're approved. That's unanimous. Okay. Okay, now we're moving on to the rest of our caucus results. Item number 3, the adoption of the town council rules. Do I have a motion?
I move that we adopt the town council rules as presented in our packet, subject to the following amendments. First, that section 1, sentence 3, have the word regular inserted between the word previous and meeting. Second, that article 3, section 6, conflict of interest, be amended as follows. Each town council member shall disclose any actual, potential, or apparent conflict of interest immediately after the chairman introduces an item. The council member shall briefly explain their reason why they believe they may have an actual, potential, or apparent conflict of interest. After reviewing applicable statutes and the code of ethics for the town council, the balance of the remaining town council members not alleged to have a conflict shall by majority vote determine if the member has a conflict. If any member of the town council believes that another member has an actual, potential, or apparent conflict of interest, they may raise a point of order at any time, and the town council shall immediately suspend business to resolve the issue. If any member discovers partway into a discussion that they may have an actual, potential, or apparent conflict of interest, the council member may raise a point of order, and the town council shall immediately suspend business to resolve the issue. All resolutions of conflicts of interest shall be by a majority vote of the remaining town council members not alleged to have a conflict, and after citing applicable statutory provisions. If the same issue is to be discussed at subsequent meetings, the recusal need not be revoted. The chairman will announce to those present the previous decision to recuse the council member.
Is there a second in support of the amendment?
Second.
Any discussion?
Well, I'd like to have that in front of me.
Yes.
What did we change?
Well, that's a good question. I've got a thought on that. Councilor Lennon?
I'm not comfortable majorly rewriting one of our rules on the fly, reading it to us and having us vote on it. It's just not the way we do business. Sometimes we don't even accept three words change in an ordinance and vote on it. I think it's totally out of regular business and I can't support it. It would need to go out to us. We would need time to read it and think about it and discuss it and re-vote. So if we want to do that, I think it should be moved to next month's meeting.
Councilor Straw.
Yes. The first modification inserts the word regular. That relates to when...
Slower.
Sure. I apologize.
Just you like jumped from one section, then I'm like...
I apologize.
And I couldn't even keep up, so...
So
where are you and what
I'll begin with Article 1, Section 1, Regular Meetings. The first proposed change is to insert the word regular between previous and meeting. This relates to when, how a meeting can be rescheduled. It makes clear that it is only to be rescheduled at a regular meeting, not at a workshop. That's the first proposed change.
Okay, so is that 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the fifth line down, previous meeting?
Correct.
Okay.
Councilor Straw, may I offer a thought on your amendment? And it's, I tend to agree with Councilor Lennon on this, and given the overarching importance of town council rules, and given that we don't have anything in writing before us, what I would ask you to consider is bringing this up at our next workshop, because it would give us and then provide us with a written comparison of the current rules and the changes you're interested in making, which, you know, I think are very worthwhile, but I'd like a little more time to absorb them. And so I'm wondering if you would be willing to revise your amendment, perhaps, and what your thoughts are on doing that. Yes, please.
So I would note that substantively, the proposed amendments do not, in my opinion, make any change to the conflict of interest provision. It instead makes clear what is necessary. I believe there may have been in the past, because of some ambiguities in the section, a lack of clarity as the proper approach. So my goal is to clarify that section. I don't believe it makes substantive changes for the most part. I am willing to move it to the workshop, but I do want us to clean up the rules going forward.
Councilor Lennon?
I just disagree. It's not that it's just a clarification. Alleged conflict of interest opens up a huge Pandora's box. What does that mean? Alleged. Any person in town could allege that someone else had one. You're broadening it out to be, you've changed the nature of it completely. So I'm agreeing with our council chair that this should go to a workshop. I'm not convinced it should be put on this week's workshop. I mean, what is precedent? Does that set anyone anytime wants to change rules of a council, they just come in and say they'd like it on the very next workshop? That could derail our agenda for that workshop. So I'm okay with it. I'm just saying, in general, I don't think you can upend things and then expect them to be addressed immediately.
Well, I think that we can have all those discussions, you know, at a workshop. When we have the time, we can devote to that. When we can have written comparisons in front of us. I mean, it may be that some of these, as Councilor Straw is suggesting, are just clarifications of wording and grammar, and that's fine, but I also would maintain that I really need to see that and be able to have a little time to compare those. And so, and any other council can bring up other concerns then. Councilor Straw?
Just to clarify, I submitted these changes. I was not a member of the town council, so lacked the ability to add them to the agenda, mm-hmm. but the town council, by way of the town manager and the chair, has had these draft changes for a number of weeks.
Well, what I would propose at this point is that those changes that you're suggesting be printed up along, you know, formally for the council today, that those changes be in a supporting documents attached to whatever workshop we put this on. I could certainly say within the next month or so. We have already been creating agendas for the next few workshops. The town manager and myself have been chatting about those already, so I think we can let the council know when that could take place. I don't know that it would necessarily be in 2 days. So, anyway, Councilor Garvin.
I'd simply make a motion to table number 3-2018, and we can pick it up on the January agenda, at which time we will have all had a better time to review and digest the changes that are being recommended. We can have open discussion at the January meeting. I'm not sure we need to wait for a workshop, but I don't think that we should be voting on it tonight.
Second.
Well, I believe a motion to table
requires a second.
And I second it.
It does, but I think it supersedes all prior discussion, if I'm correct. So
and ends all discussion.
I think it also ends the discussion. So I think that's where we are. I think that's parliamentary procedure. And so I don't think we even need to vote on that, as long as a motion to table it. Am I correct?
A motion to table.
Point of order. We do need to vote if there is a pending motion.
No, not if we table it. I think to lay on the table, it may not.
Point of order, two members cannot lay an item on the table. It requires a majority.
You vote to table it.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
That's what
all
she
right.
said. You got to listen to the whole thing that comes out of. She said, we don't vote on your motion, but she's saying we vote on the motion to table. So just deep breath, Chris, and I think you'll.
All right. Thank you, Councilor Jordan. All those in favor? Opposed? It's 6-1. Thank you.
Point of order, Madam Chair?
Yes.
We currently now do not have any operating town council rules for the remainder of this meeting.
No rules.
Could I have a motion to reinstate the current town council rules? Council Lennon.
So moved.
Seconded.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? All right. Thank you, Council Starr. All right, next item number 4, appointment of the Finance Committee. Jamie Garvin is chairman, and the council as a whole, for the audience at home, the council itself is the Finance Committee. And so the caucus is recommending that Jamie Garvin serve as Finance Chairman. Is there a motion?
I move that Jamie Garvin be become chair of the Finance Committee.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Caitlin Jordan, all those in favor?
Discussion.
Discussion on, I'm sorry, yes, go ahead.
This is an important position. The chair of the Finance Committee is, in effect, the head of the town's council when we're dealing with issues of finance. That's a very important issue. This position is second only to the chair of the town council, and it demands the appointment of a member that inspires a sense of trust and integrity in our town's government. I believe Councilor Garvin is likely just such a candidate. That said, I think it's quite clear that our town has been suffering from a lack of trust in its elected officials. I think that's demonstrated by the fact that Ms. Randall, who's new to town, was the top vote getter in this last election. And so, in order for Councilor Garvin to earn my vote for the position of chair of the Finance Committee, what I'm going to need is for him to help me rebuild what I deem the well of trust. And I realize this sounds very flowery, but this is the way that I view these things. The town council, in effect, has a well of trust. It is a well of trust that we build and fill up by virtue of how we act as a group. It's how we treat the general public. It's do we, through our actions, set a standard such that people look to us and say, we trust that body. What happens is when you act appropriately over an extended period of time, you fill that well. And then on occasion, difficult questions arise, difficult issues. And if you have built up that well of trust, what happens is you can draw from it and it doesn't empty. There's still some water there. And by virtue of that, people will accept your decisions. What happens is if you draw from that well too often without refilling it, it runs empty. And then people begin to doubt the town council. So what I'm looking for is for Councillor Garvin to help me refill that well of trust. And therefore, what I'm looking for is for you to now voluntarily make a complete and full disclosure of your relationship to the abutters of Surfside Avenue. And let me give you an example of what I'm asking for. I have personal relationships to, and just to be clear, this is relevant to what is needed for me to have faith in Councillor Garvin by virtue so that I can vote for him for this position. And that is why it is relevant to the issue at hand. So what I am looking for is simply a statement, and obviously you don't need to make this, and I will be asking this of all the town councilors. I'm not singling you out. I'm asking for everyone to help me rebuild this well of trust. What I'm looking for is a statement of, I have personal relationships with these individuals. I have acquaintance relationships with these individuals. I have association relationships with these individuals. For example, I have acquaintance relationships with Martha Palmer, who I believe lives nearby, with the Inkers, with the Leopolds. I have personal relationships with the Rinaldis, with the Reynolds, and I have association relationships with Mr. Khalidi and Rebecca Millett. I will go into detail with all of those later in the night at the appropriate time. But what I'm asking for is that you voluntarily make a disclosure as to what your relationships are to the individuals.
I'd like to make a point of order, Councillor Strahl. I think that you are completely within your rights to raise these concerns. I think that if you, I don't see the relevance, I don't agree with your contention that this is relevant to Councilor Garvin's role as finance chair. I would suggest that if you want to have a discussion on the well of trust that you're describing and potential relationships and perhaps conflicts of interest that you're raising, that we set a specific time for that and not go through those discussions with all of these assignments. I think that for one reason, it would notice the public properly that sort of discussion would take place. This is not something that anyone would think would come along with our normal, usually very matter-of-fact appointments of committee chairmanships and appointments that were made at a caucus. And so I would ask you to refrain from this line of discussion and be willing to consider this at a different date, at a different venue. Council Lennon.
I agree again with Council Chair. We effectively had this whole conversation in workshop, which we spent a whole workshop on coming up with our slate. I think we did a great job. I think it's what you're asking is already implicit by our supporting Jamie to be our finance chair. And if I can just, in all kindness and respect, suggest that as a freshman member that has just joined during your first 45 minutes of our first meeting, that you kind of get a feel of the lay of the land and how things go. And I appreciate your passion and your energy and your enthusiasm to tighten up strings and make things better, but I think if you just sort of let things flow for a little while and see how we do things, maybe at least through this meeting, then you can start to sprinkle in your suggestions for how we might make it better. But respectfully, I think that you're going on too many tangents and we have a very long agenda. So I would just encourage you to just observe for a little bit.
If I may, I'd like to add that I support your right to discuss discuss these concerns. I just would ask that they take place at a different time and not tonight's meeting. May I take another counselor? Yeah.
I was just going to say, I agree with Jessica as well, that I think you have every right to engage in the conversation of your trust well of trust, but I think it needs to be properly noticed, and it needs to be far more reaching than just Surfside Avenue if you truly want to talk about a well of trust. Right now, it seems like you're picking a fight about Surfside, and I'm not sure that's what you're intending to do, but if you want to truly build up the integrity and the trust of the council, you can't pinpoint it to one incident because it makes it seem like you're going after just one thing. There's been lots of things that we could bring up over the past years, and right now is not the time to be bringing this up. Right now we're talking about the Finance Committee and the appointment of that, which has nothing to do with Surfside Avenue.
So, Councilor Starr.
Yes. I would note that I believe tonight is the proper time. I was hoping to discuss it at this point. There is an item later on the agenda where this all will come up at that point. I was attempting to address it in a collegial manner rather than addressing it in the context of conflicts. Again, I was not asking about conflicts, and I'm in no way implying there is necessarily a conflict. I was just looking for disclosure of relationships. I'm free to ask my question. I think it goes to whether I feel that I trust my fellow members. Obviously, none of you need answer my question, and we can proceed with the vote if that's the way that everyone wants to proceed.
Would the clerk read the original motion, please?
Board number four.
Mm-hmm.
It was moved and seconded to appoint Jamie Garvin as chairman of the Finance Committee.
And it was seconded.
And it was seconded.
Okay. Any further discussion?
Just as a thought, yep. Regarding conflict of interest questions, we will be having a workshop with the town attorney on Thursday evening, and part of the freedom of access discussion is also related to conflict of interest, so that may be a good point to, I know it's not here this evening, but it may also be a good fruitful point to have some of those discussion topics as well. Thank you.
Councilor Garvin?
I will look forward to those discussions, and in so much as that this question was directed at me, I will answer that my integrity is above reproach, and I will welcome any discussion that challenges it.
All right. Thank you. All those in favor? Opposed? All right. Item number five, appointment of ordinance committee. The caucus recommends that Penelope Jordan serve as chairman, Caitlin Jordan and Valerie Randall serve as the other members of the ordinance committee. Is there a motion? Caitlin?
So moved.
Second. Councilor Lennon? Any discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous. Okay. Item number six. Appointment of an appointments committee. The caucus recommends that Sarah Lennon serve as chairman, Jamie Garvin and Christopher Straw serve as the other members of the town council's appointments committee. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Thank you, Valerie. And Caitlin seconds. Any discussion?
Discussion. Once again, I believe the chairmanship position of the appointments committee is a serious position. For me to have faith in the appointment of Councillor Lennon, for me to have a sense that she is supporting transparency in our government, I would ask again that she voluntarily answer the same questions I posed to Councillor Garvin.
Thank you, Councillor Lennon.
I would just echo what Jamie said, and I look forward to the discussion when it's appropriate.
Any other discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? 6-1. Thank you. Item number 7 through 6, we're proposing to take as a consent agenda. I'm sorry, items number 7 through 16, which finishes out the appointment of representatives to EcoMaine, appointment of representatives to Greater Portland Council of Governments, to the PACS Policy Committee, to the Maine Medical Association Legislative Policy Committee, to the Thomas Memorial Library, and so on through item number 16. Is there a motion?
So to moved.
I'm sorry.
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Madam Chair?
Any discussion?
I divide the question to separate out item 16.
Okay. Okay. All right.
So we got to vote on dividing that.
We have an amendment.
I think you're okay.
Okay. I think we can divide the question without a vote. So in that case, could I have a motion to approve items number 7 through 15?
So moved.
And is there a second on that? All right. All those in favor? It's unanimous. Items number 7 through 15 have been approved. And so we have had a request to take out item number 16, which is continued service on Comprehensive Plan Committee and Harbors Committee. The Council Caucus confirmed the continued service on the following ad hoc committees for Penelope Jordan and Sarah Lennon to continue on the Comprehensive Plan Committee, and for Caitlin Jordan and Catherine Ray, former town councilor, to continue on the Harbors Committee. Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Councilor Jordan, any discussion?
I would note that I will be supporting Councilor Penelope Jordan and Councilor Sarah Lennon for the Comprehensive Plan Committee. I did want to acknowledge Councilor Penelope Jordan's handling of my pointing out the fact that the appointment wasn't handled properly last year, and I do appreciate that. Thank you. With respect to the Harbors Committee, I am concerned that the appointment of Councillor Caitlin Jordan to the Harbors Committee poses a conflict of interest. I recognize she has been on it for the last year. My understanding is that the focus of the Harbors Committee's work has been with respect to the commercial boat ramp at the far end of town. My understanding is that it is unclear how many commercial fishermen there are in town. I recognize that Councillor Caitlin Jordan has experience in this area that dwarfs all the rest of ours. Nevertheless, I am concerned and do feel we may need to cabin or somehow place some restrictions on her participation in this issue by virtue of the fact that, by my count, there's approximately 11 commercial moorings down in that area, and 7 of them belong to either her family or the Perry family. So in other words, a majority of these moorings are affiliated with either Councillor Caitlin Jordan or the Perry family. That gives me pause. It causes me a little concern, it brings into question whether she has any personal or familiar interests that might at times be adverse to the interests of the general public with respect to this issue. I think that she can probably participate on the committee, but I do think we need to place some restrictions on what she can do as a committee member.
Well, Councilor Lennon?
I think Caitlin is more than capable of deciding herself when she thinks she might have a conflict of interest, disclosing it and taking those actions on the committee. I have complete faith she will do that.
What I would propose is, again, as with the other items, when you raise these questions, Councilor Straw, that we continue that discussion when we have when we plan to have the other discussions with the town attorney and our conflict of interest and FOA review. Councilor Caitlin?
Well, I actually disagree with that. I think we could handle this one right now. I mean, I was appointed to the Harbors Committee last year with the same knowledge and the same disclosure that I have family members that are within the fishing community. Also, the Harbors Committee's charge is to look at access, not just for commercial fishermen, but for the town in general. We have reviewed water access across town, all water access, public, private. We've gone on field trips to every access point within Cape Elizabeth. We looked at the, you know, we have done far more than just anything that deals with commercial fishing. We as a committee have no impact on the moorings. That's all handled by the harbor master, who has also been involved in the committee. I strongly oppose that I have any kind of conflict that makes it so that I cannot represent the general public in this manner. We discussed this when I was appointed to the committee over a year ago.
Councilor Randall?
It doesn't seem to me that on its face there's any issue with Caitlin being appointed to the committee, but I would suggest that maybe we handle this as Harbor Committee's issues come before the council, if another council member believes that there is a conflict, maybe we could raise it at that point. But I don't think that at this time there's a conflict that's apparent, at least.
Okay, thank you. Any other, Councilor Straw?
And I think that's the Councilor Randall's point is what I'm attempting to convey here. And I realize I may not be doing it in an articulate way, and I apologize if I've upset you in attempting to get at these issues. My understanding, and again, we don't have the town attorney here, is that there are three categories of conflict. There is a actual conflict, a potential conflict, and an appearance conflict. And my concern is the appearance conflict. Do I believe that you can handle yourself appropriately? Do I believe you can address these issues and look out for the town's best interests? Yes. Do I think that you know this material far better than the rest of us? Absolutely. The question goes to the appearance. It is measured from an outside perspective, and that's what I'm concerned about. And again, I'm not saying that we can't appoint you to this position, but we do need to be cognizant of the fact that there is an appearance that we do need to deal with.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan?
I completely agree with the three categories, and that is why we vetted out the whole conflict of interest issues a couple years ago, and we have a statement coming up that we follow the ethics rules, because these things kept coming up where I was friends with this person, or you were friends with that person, you were related. This is a small town. The fact that you don't know anybody or you're not involved in something that's going on means you're probably not involved enough in the town. So that's why we had the disclosures, and we made these disclosures when we appointed this. So we've had this conversation, but I can gladly make them all again. Yes, I know lots of commercial fishermen in town. Yes, my family has moorings in town. I made those same disclosures when I was appointed to the Harbors Committee. I've just made them again. I myself hold a commercial lobster license. I don't actively lobster out of Cape Elizabeth, but I do hold the license. I don't have a mooring myself. I do know the Perrys because they live here in town. They have their whole life, so have I. So we've crossed paths a few times. Those are the disclosures that our code of ethics require that helps with the appearance of a conflict, so that anybody who's paying attention now knows that, yes, I have these, what would you call, connections, but I do not feel as though I'm conflicted.
Thank you. And
very quick.
Okay, please.
That's exactly what I've been looking for. Thank you. It's just putting it out there so that people are aware of it. When it's in the background, it causes the whisper campaigns. It causes people to wonder what's going on. Just put it out there. That's all I am looking for. So thank you. I'm not saying you have a conflict. I'm looking for the disclosure. Thank you.
But it was disclosed.
I'd like to call the question unless there's anything else. Councilor Garvin?
I have a few things. Number one is that I would reiterate that this was discussed, considered, and talked about at length at the formation of the Harbors Committee. I don't know how much we need to, in perpetuity, continue to disclose things for the benefit of those who maybe weren't here at the time that a decision was made or a discussion happened. So that's something that we can all consider, but I remember distinctly having conversation about this. The other thing I remember is that we specifically informing the committee appointed two councillors to the committee for this very reason, so that there was balance, there were differing points of view. And the third thing I'll point out is that this is an ad hoc committee that actually is supposed to be concluding their work. I believe it's going to be asking for an extension, but we're looking at approximately 3 more months of work. I think we're spending an inordinate amount of time discussing something that hopefully they're going to be bringing their work to an end, and this will become a moot point rather quickly. Thank you.
Thank you. So we have a second motion and second in the table. All those in favor of appointing Penelope Jordan, Sarah Lennon to the Comprehensive Plan Committee, and Caitlin Jordan and Catherine Ray, former town councilor, to the Harbors Committee. That's unanimous. Thank you. Okay, item number 17, Code of Ethics. The town council rules provide that each council member will annually sign an attestation that they have read and understand the council code of ethics. I believe the town clerk has our forms ready for signature, and we sign now. So we'll just pass those along. Pardon? You want to pass those?
Did you want to vote on the code?
I'm sorry?
Did you want to vote on the code?
Yes. So So, may I have a motion to vote on the Code of Ethics?
So moved.
And a second? And Councilor Garvin? Any discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous?
Do you want to start?
Yep. And I will sign off as a witness, and this will be filed in the town clerk's office for future.
Great. Thank you. Next item, number 18, is a schedule of council meetings for the year 2018, the upcoming year. We have these all listed in front of us. Is there a motion on the table to accept the schedule? Council Lennon?
I move we accept the schedule for our 2017-18 meetings.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Councilor Randall, any discussion? All right. All those in favor? All right. The next item is a public hearing on a changes to the off-leash area in Fort Williams Park. On October 11, the town council referred this to the ordinance committee, referred to the ordinance committee, a recommendation of the Fort Williams Park Committee to change the existing delineation of the off-leash area in Fort Williams Park, Chapter 7, Dogs, Section 7-1-7, Dogs, to be restrained on municipal property. So I'd like to open the public hearing.
Parliamentary question?
I'm sorry?
A parliamentary question. Is there any rule that would require me to recuse myself by virtue of the fact that I participated as a member of the Fort Williams Park Commission?
I don't believe so.
Right. Thank you.
So if you would please give us your name and address. You have 3 minutes, and if the clerk could watch the clock for us.
Mm-hmm. Hi, I'm Heidi Hansen, 313 Fowler Road. Before I get started, I'd like to clarify the town manager's report on that has to do with this ordinance. On the Gulf Crest area, this ordinance says that the groomed areas of the town should be on leash. Gold Crest is a huge property, and I think you should have said the Gold Crest athletic fields should be off-leash, or on-leash, rather than the whole Gold Crest property. Just saying.
Yes,
I can clarify after if you want. I'll jump in now if you don't mind.
Yep, go ahead.
The chief had instructed to me that they consider that that's the entirety of Gold Crest. Because of the trails and the athletic fields that are up there, and but that was his indication to me was that it was the entirety of the property.
Okay, I think that should be up for discussion later at some point in time, because many people use the trails and the fields, not the athletic fields, but they use the fields off leash, and that's not very clear right now to the rest of the people in the town with the dogs.
I would share your opinion on that as well.
All right. So, first of all, I'm here to support this ordinance change. I think that many people who have off-leash dogs or who walk the dogs off-leash are in support of it. Certainly, many of the people that I talk to down at Fort Williams, and I go down there pretty much two times a day, are very much in favor of it, and we support the careful work that's been done by the commission or the committee, and as well as the ordinance committee, and it's been really thoughtfully done, and most people agree with it. I just want to, one of the reasons I'm here is to reply to a comment that former Councilor Ray made at the ordinance committee meeting, which was concern about enforcement of this ordinance. and expense of it. And I think that those who are involved in Fort Williams and the off-leash area know that it's a pretty tight group. We do have concerns about enforcement, and we address those mostly at the committee level in dealing with signage. Our biggest problem is with visitors in the summer. We're a pretty tight-knit group, and we really communicate with each other and try to keep the dogs off the field. The temporary fence has been a blessing for soccer season, for keeping the dogs off the field, and we really appreciate it. Do you have something to say?
Ms. Hansen, if you could, your 3 minutes are up, if you could wrap it up, please.
Okay. I was just giving thanks. So I just have one minor point to make, if you don't mind, on the ordinance 717B, at the last sentence, it says that dogs shall not be allowed on the athletic fields between November 1st, or between April 1st and November 1st. And my question, and maybe Bob can clarify this, I don't think they meant all dogs. I think they meant off-leash dogs. Because we have many visitors who come to watch the soccer games, and they come with the dogs on leash. And I just wanted to have that clarified.
Thank you.
That's a good point.
Okay. Is there anyone else?
My name is Roger Rio. I live 5 Briar Pathway. First, I want to say it's a great addition to have a place where dogs can go, be free, and socialize. I do have some concerns about the ordinance and certainly about enforcement. I would ask to start with is that the athletic field be considered not off-leash at all, ever. That is built for children to play sports. All other athletic fields, or almost all of them, are either fenced in and have posted no animals on the fields. Even in the wintertime, I just don't see that the feces will be picked up in the deep snow and that kind of thing. And also, when we have thaw, there can be some damage to those fields. I would ask that maybe some point we fence in that field so that it be a permanent area for athletics. I'm also a member of the Little League board, and we got permission this last year for T-ball to be played there, which was a great addition. And there was at least one incident with a dog, but it was a minor one. But it is an area where dogs should be on leash whenever people are there. Also, my biggest concern is enforcement. The rules made without enforcement are useless. There are dogs all over the park that are off leash. My wife walks our dog there many days of the week, and see dogs all over the park that are off leash. They are residents of the town. They know better. When we mention it to them, they say, my dog's under control. No, they're not. And we find dog bags with feces in them under benches, under tables, and around trees, and they're just leaving them everywhere. And it is very frustrating as a dog owner to have a dog off leash come running after our dog in that area, which is supposed to be on leash. So I would encourage you to discuss at least what we can do about enforcement, and perhaps the athletic field to be limited to only when dogs are on leash. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? I shall close the public hearing. So, item number 19, change to the off-leash area in Fort Williams Park. Following the public hearing, the town council may adopt or refer back to the ordinance committee for further review or refer the vote to a regular meeting on January 8, 2018. So is there any discussion or a motion, Councilor Randall?
I don't know the proper procedure. Do we move to send this back to the ordinance committee? Is that the proper way to...
Not necessarily, and what we should do is have a motion on the table in order to start discussion. But we could do a variety of things. We could send it back to ordinance. It depends on what the council's discussion is about this item.
I have some further points to make with regard to that. One, I do think that last sentence that Ms. Hansen brought up was confusing. Mm-hmm. I also read that and thought, did they mean dogs are prohibited, period, or just unleashed? So I think that's an issue. We need some more clarification on. And I also think this enforcement point is valid and deserves further discussion and exploration.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Any other? Okay.
I was going to make a motion.
Yep.
I move that we send the language to our next council to be voted on with the change to the last sentence of subsection B. To read that unleashed dogs are prohibited on the multipurpose field from April 1st to November 1st, because I too had the same thought that, as she brings up, just the simple example of, you know, you can bring your dog on a leash to watch your kid's soccer game, but we don't want them unleashed. So,
all right, is there a second? Councilor Straw?
Seconded.
All right, is there any discussion?
Can I just ask a point of clarification?
Yes.
For anybody from the ordinance committee, which I think you're the last one that was. Was that the point, and it was just it was just miscommunicated?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Can I may I ask a question of the ordinance committee?
Yes.
Was enforcement discussed? Because I agree that it is a gap here around enforcement.
We discussed it briefly in the fact that hopefully we're getting a new park manager, but that short of creating police officers in the park, there's nothing you can do. You know, it's an enforcement issue like any other enforcement. How do you enforce people from not jaywalking? You know what I mean? Like, you need to have somebody there to enforce it. So I think it's further down on, or it's on our workshop. I saw it on an agenda somewhere that we're discussing the how we're going to enforce it, but that's not something that would be put into an ordinance, right? That's a problem outside of the ordinance language. You wouldn't write an ordinance and say, here's how you enforce it. You have an ordinance and then you get somebody to enforce it. So I don't see how enforcement is going to change the language.
Okay. Well, if you just could hold off for a second, Council Lennon. Captain Sinclair is here to talk about this, about enforcement. Also, our Public Works Director is here. I've got some questions for both of them. So if it's all right with the Council, I think we could hear from both of them. Is Captain Sinclair? There he is.
Good evening.
Thank you. So we have concerns about enforcement. Could you talk to us about that?
What we currently have is we have a part-time animal control officer that we use from Southport, and we pay 20% of his salary, so he's supposed to spend 20% of his time out here. And I'd say that Fort Williams is a place where he spends quite a bit of time. A, it's close to the line, and B, he knows that that's where dogs are off-leash. I don't know if there's any discussion about trying to, you know, add more animal control, whether we want to have our own. But we also, I mean, we spend a lot of time, all patrol officers spend a lot of time in Fort Williams Park as well. And if we see a dog that's off leash, it gets addressed. Mm-hmm. Doesn't necessarily mean there's a citation issue, but it gets addressed.
Okay.
So if there was a change, it would seem to me that whenever there's some sort of change, we try to take enforcement action right away. You know, we'll spend more time down there. We won't necessarily be writing citations, but we'd be spending more time down there to make sure that people are abiding by the changes to the regulations.
Does it seem that we are... Well, I guess my question is our enforcement enough? Because we certainly have had some complaints. And we've had some attacks and so forth, so, you know. Or maybe it's time to start giving out citations. I mean, I'm just asking, because this is something that has been brought up, you know, concerns that people have with dogs that are off-leash. And, you know, I will say that certainly in my experience, it's the rarest of situation, in my opinion, that someone actually has true voice control over a dog. I just, you know, but anyway, what are your thoughts on that?
In the last 5 years, we've had 55 calls for service that involved dogs, animals, and three of those were dog bites, and three of them were rabid animals, and the rest of them were just uncharacterized. I mean, it could have been a barking dog, it could have been a dog that was locked in the car that doesn't say anything specific in the CAD calls, but we've only had three bites, and there were three calls for rabid animals.
So would that have been within the 20% enforcement of our animal control officer, or is that with his time at Fort Williams as well as our officers just randomly being there for other reasons and observing a dog off leash? It's a combination?
Yeah, I guess I'm not clear on what the question is.
Well, in the calls that you've had in the last 5 years for dog issues at Fort Williams, were those handled or called into the animal control officer, or was that a combination of the animal control officer and our own police force?
It would have been a combination. Okay. If the animal control officer is available, he gets dispatched on all animal calls out here. If he's not available, then we respond.
Okay, great, thank you. Council Lennon?
Were those calls all to the fort or to anywhere in town?
That's just the Fort Williams.
And my other question is, in terms of like the animal waste that one speaker was talking about, what if a dog's on a leash, does that, are you assuming then that they don't sort of go to the bathroom there, or the person, are there signs that say please pick up after your dog? Or because I used to coach on that field and there was a problem. So is it your impression that if all dogs had to be leashed during that off season that it would cut down on the amount of waste that gets left behind?
I don't think it would necessarily change that.
Because that seems to me an issue that we should address. Kids were always stepping in it.
Councilor Garvin?
Do you think that the, in your opinion, is the lack of current compliance at all due to some of the vague language and ambiguity of the current ordinance? So some of the calls, and I think we heard one of the citizens say that there's, you know, dogs off leash in various parts of the park. Do you think that some of the vague language in the current ordinance contributes to that?
My opinion is no. I don't think that really is much of a factor.
Okay. Would you say that, and I don't know if you've read this language, but do you think that this will help address some of that problem, though, in so much as that it clarifies both in terms of months of use and areas of use?
Yeah, it seems like it might address some of those.
Thank you.
All right, any other questions for Captain Sinclair? Thank you.
Thank you, that's right.
And I wonder if, is Bob here? Yep, if Bob Malley, our Public Works Director, could come up. I've got a question about the area, the unleashed area. So as we understand it, what's being proposed is to limit, to not allow dogs off-leash on the multi-purpose athletic field between April 1st and November 1st. And I also understand that the Fort Williams Park Committee is recommending that the current off-leash area, which is, I would include the field that looks at the lighthouse, be expanded. Can you show us, would you please?
Thank you.
Go ahead.
So a couple of things. I think the map is has a lot more clarification than the previous map. We've identified the current boundaries of the area. We've shown the athletic field obviously in the middle, and then we've highlighted the area that's proposed to be added. And I think if you look at the text in 7-1-7, I think it does a better job of explaining or delineating the area. It was a little gray before. It was a little bit confusing of whether it abutted Humphreys Road, it just said southerly of Humphreys Road. But I think our definition as proposed is much clearer in how it delineates the area. So it includes this area that abuts Delano Park. Includes the area of the southerly extension of the cliff walk, it includes the road, and then above the southerly end of Battery Blair, it would take a westerly turn and take a northerly turn and then back to the parking lot. It is proposed too to add some additional signage to better delineate all these areas where it says limit of off-leash area or begin off-leash area. So we clearly need some more signage depending on where people enter the park, the off-leash area to make sure that that's clear. So the intent would be, I know there was some discussion at the ordinance committee level of creating a map near the park's storage buildings that people could actually see something like this that would give them a sense of the proposed area. And a lot of folks enter through the old main gate, so there will be some signage in this particular area too. So I think it has the accommodation signage to better guide people, but I think the committee, Mark Russell is here as chair of the park committee, I think everybody's comfortable with this proposed addition in this particular area. And it's a sort of an unimproved area of the green, which is this area here. So we're supportive of the extension of the area.
So the place that is white with the dots, that is the current off-leash area. And the road that goes down, so the green area is what you're proposing as the addition. Is this the area that walks along a path and comes to a little point where you can stand by on a fence and you look at Delano Park on the right? It's kind of a little outcropping there.
This red line is the southerly extension of the cliff walk.
Yep.
And it sort of encompasses that, and there is an area that's a point, it's a little bit tricky to get out to, but it does encompass the shoreline, what you say to the water. There's actually a fence along there that, you know, restricts people, or hopefully restricts people from getting down on the rocks.
So when you come to that point, because I walk there in the summer, there's so many people, I don't go with my dogs, I have two dogs, but I walk there all the time in the winter and then in the spring. When you come around that area, the green area, and you come around that point, and you can cut back into the field.
Correct.
You know what I'm talking about? That spot. There's a hill, a raised area where a trail goes up and then down. Could you point to that spot that I'm talking about?
I think the path comes down and it's right about here. There's an area where you can get back onto the cliff walk.
Right.
It's like a little shortcut through behind Battery Garrochet.
It can be pretty muddy there. Yeah.
But I think the intent here is to include all of this area. It's a little bit tricky with the delineation of the map and the GIS system.
Well, so the icon you have of people, is that where the porta potties are currently? You've this right up there. Is that?
In that particular area, yeah.
Okay. So, and could you please point to the spot where the benches are and where the faucet is, where the water, in the summer, there's usually a...
The watering station is right about in this area. And that was a little bit, that was another piece of this, that the watering station was outside of the delineation. So the watering station is included, and there's probably two or three benches along this area that are also included in this area. But it does include the watering station.
So if we approve that area, the green shaded area, if we approve that expansion, how are we going to prevent off-leash dogs from running towards the lighthouse and the people and just signage, or
Well, there'll have to be a combination of signage and enforcement to help out with that. And the park rangers can assist to a certain extent, but I think signage is obviously the best way to determine and we'll say limit of off-leash area. So that's okay. That's what I would say the best way to do it.
Did anyone else have any questions? No? Or Bob? Okay, thank you. So what was the motion on the table? Did we have a motion? I've lost myself.
Change the last sentence to unleashed dogs.
Jessica?
Yes.
Go right ahead. I just want to say that I actually agree with Councillor Lennon and Roger Rio. I don't think dogs should be allowed on athletic fields at all. I think that the April to November, it should be that they aren't allowed there at all. Mm-hmm. You're going to have dogs running there in the wintertime, snow melts, and people don't always clean up after their dogs. So I personally think that it should be revisited overall.
Anyone else? I actually support that. I think they should be not allowed on athletic fields no matter what time of year.
Right.
I think it's a huge safety issue for children. And I share Councilor Lennon's concerns about the people not picking up. It's not just there, but it's all over the place. But at any rate, the motion we have on the table is to, and we were going to change that last sentence. Jamie, did you, was it this one or something else? Did you offer that we revisit this in January?
It was part of
Councilor Jordan's.
Councilor Jordan's to refer it with the revised language to a January vote.
Okay. All right. Now, as far as the Councilor Penny Jordan's comments, what do other councils think about that? Because if we refer it back, you know, are we going to refer it back with any other changes or not? Does anyone else have thoughts on whether we completely preclude dogs from these athletic fields? Caitlin?
I think we should bring Bob back up here and ask him why he thinks that dogs should be allowed on this athletic field for the, 5 months out of the year versus the other athletic fields where they're banned completely. I'd just like to know what his reply.
Mm-hmm. Or Chairman Russell from the Fort Williams Committee as well.
Yeah, well.
My only take is that, like, for example, there's some snow on the ground today. I think our concern is turf damage, and during the athletic season, Little League starts early in the year, there's sporadic events in the summer, there's events in the fall, so I thought that the intent was if the ground's frozen, there's not the susceptibility of damage to the turf. But obviously, in a perfect world, you know, athletic fields and dogs are usually not compatible. South Portland, for example, the Wainwright Complex, I don't believe they allow any dogs on the fields down there. But the sense was that there could be more damage and there's more activities on the fields between these months.
Jamie?
I'm not sure if you clarified, though, what led to the decision for inclusion of use in the off months, though. So understanding that they shouldn't be on during the playing months, but I think the question was, there are other fields in town that have a complete prohibition on dogs on those fields at any time of the year, yet this seems to be an exception. So was that? Could you enlighten us on the committee's opinion as it related to that and the recommendation that went to the...
I defer to Mark Russell, but I think the sense was to keep the dogs off during the playing season. I think that was the priority of the discussion. The concern was that it's a safety concern, and those would be months where there would be organized activities on the field. I think that was the genesis of the discussion.
Councilor Jordan?
Would you clarify? I don't think it's a Fort Williams issue. I think it's a public works issue. Okay, so how come we don't allow dogs on golf course lacrosse fields during off season? I guess would be what we're asking, because the current ordinance says can't be on athletic fields, but
you're saying that they can be on this athletic field for these 5 months, so how come they can't be on the Gulf Crest field? So if we're going to make this ordinance this way, then let's open it up to that same policy for all athletic fields.
I think there needs to be a larger conversation about all of our athletic fields. I think the way the ordinance reads, they can be on the athletic fields as long as they're leashed.
Right. Off, correct.
Yeah, they're leashed.
Yep.
So I think that's a conversation that we need to have. It's not specific to this recommendation, but it's a larger conversation that the council should have.
All right, and Jamie?
I'd like to see if Chairman Russell has anything to say.
Great. Thanks. Thank you, Bob. Well, Mark?
Specific question?
Yeah, I would just
put the same question I put to Bob. If you could just enlighten us from the committee's discussions around the exception.
It was a compromise.
Yep, thank
it
you.
It was a compromise. There were clearly people on the committee who wanted no access to the field for dogs, on leash or off leash. It's a playing field. And there were others on the committee that said, this is a piece of property that the town has allowed this sort of use. If we take it away completely, we're going to have to find some other place for dogs to play. And this particular, this was a compromise.
All right. Any questions, other questions for Mark Russell, who's the chairman of the Fort Williams Park Committee? Oh, all right, thank you.
I have a quick question. So, do you think that the committee came to a consensus that it was okay to allow dogs on the off season, but once the season starts, there's no dogs?
Yes.
Not even a leash, nothing. No dog steps on that field.
No, I think it was, I think I'll echo what the captain said. I think a dog on a leash is under control. A dog that's not on a leash is not necessarily under control. And this is my opinion and not the committee's opinion. I'm in the park every day. And I can't remember being in the park when I didn't see a dog off leash in an area where it shouldn't have been off leash. It happens every day. And it's a question that the town as a whole needs to get its hands around. It's not just in Fort Williams. This is a particular recommendation that the Fort Williams Committee is making. But it's an issue that needs to be addressed.
So is it your impression, being there all the time, that if the dog is on leash and someone's on that field, that they pick up after their dog?
That would be my impression. That would be my impression.
I guess I'm not good at that.
But you've coached there. You know the reality. And I share Roger's concern about just litter. It's a carry-in, carry-out park. We don't supply trash barrels for dog litter. It ends up everywhere. And I'm grateful to the people in the park who work with dogs and are there all the time. There is a core group that works very hard. But there's a lot more than that.
Yep, Jamie?
Point of clarification, we do have several dog waste stations in the park, don't we?
I don't know.
There's one at the old gate. There's one down by Battery Garish.
Is there dog waste?
Yeah, there is.
So we provide both bags and a disposal location.
There's more than one place for dog waste in the park, more than two. But we may supply a couple of barrels.
Any other questions from Mark? Thank you. Thank you very much. I've got a question, I think, for Bob Malley, and it's, he may not have the answer, but, and I'm sorry I didn't think of this before, but Dogs off leash in the park, I think, are a relatively new activity. I think since I've been on the council that we allowed them off leash at all. I don't think that's been a long-term thing. I think that happened, I want to say around 2010 or 11, perhaps, something like that.
Yeah, I'm don't specifically recall when the off-leash area was created, but
yep.
there's been a dedicated group of folks yep. who walk there, and you know, it's part social and part exercising the dogs, but it's been quite a while.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Thanks. Well,
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Question for Bob. If I vaguely recall, this ordinance that defined this as off-leash, though, dates back to, like, the 1990s? Is that right?
It could be, but it could have started with Lionsfield. I'm not sure when the Fort Wayne yeah. area was added in, but it could have started in the Lionsfield area, which has been organized here, Fort Monmouth.
So it may be that it has been off leash for a good 15, 20 years.
Thank you. So what are councilors thinking? I mean, you know, this, it could be that we need to refer this back to ordinance. We need some more work on this. And that's what I'm hearing. We've got some questions. What are people thinking? Oh, Caitlin had her hand up first.
Oh, just that there's a motion on the table to move the question forward. So if people want to send it back to council, I think that motion needs to be voted down.
Yes. Jamie?
I'm in favor of moving this on to the January meeting as Caitlin proposed. I think the question of use by dogs, leash, unleashed, or whatever, on any athletic field should be separated out, handled separately. We can always come back and further amend the ordinance if necessary. I don't think that we should be addressing, this is a recommendation relative to specifically to Fort Williams, mm-hmm. and I think we're letting a larger issue come into the decisioning here, and I think we should try and keep those things separate. So I favor forwarding this on as is, voting on it in January, and if there's further discussion that the council wants to take up about whether any dog should be on any playing field at all, mm-hmm. We can take that up as a separate issue.
Well, I'm not sure. I'm not quite sure I understand you. When you say other issues are coming into this, what exactly did you mean?
About whether or not dogs should be on any athletic field in town, Fort Williams or otherwise. So if we want to have separate discussion about that and then further amend the dog leash ordinance to reflect that discussion, I don't think we should be trying to solve two problems with one vote is my point.
Okay, we could amend that.
We can always amend later to address yeah. all of the athletic fields.
Okay, so I mean, you know, I'm certainly in favor of our policy on athletic fields being uniform within the town, but we can move this to January. As Jamie suggests. Okay, is there support for that? Okay, so where are we with our motion, Ben?
Okay, there is, it was moved by Councilor Caitlin Jordan, seconded by Councilor Straw, to amend Section B, the last sentence. It would say, unleashed dogs are prohibited on the multipurpose athletic field from April 1st to November 1st, and defer the vote to January 8th.
Okay. All those in favor? Opposed? One. Okay, thank you. All right, next item number 20, Fort Williams Park, food vending sites, recommended changes. I'd like the town manager to tee this up, please.
Sure, and I know Bob's here as well to, yep. to speak about this. What we have here is some suggestions from the Fort Williams Park Committee related to changing a couple different elements of the vendor sites that we do have currently at the park. The first item that they have would be under the vendor permit fees, where they adjusting what the current amounts are and changing them up to or down depending upon the site to different levels. So, for instance, there are four different sites that we currently allow vendors to be located at, and that would be from April 1st until the middle of November. There's one at Portland Headlight South, which is on the right side of the circle. Portland Headlight North, which is on the left side of the circle as you're approaching the headlight, and then Channel Overlook, which is currently where Bite Into Main is located, up on the top of the hill on the right-hand side as you're coming towards the lighthouse. And then finally down at Ship Cove, there's Site D, which is down and to the left towards where the beach is, off to that little parking area in there. And you, as you can see, the originally Portland Light South was at $4,000 for minimum bid. It's recommended to change that to $2,000 and then increases on the north and the overlook to 4,500 feet each of those, and then lowering the ship code from 3,000 to 2,000 for a minimum bid. It does not restrict people to bid more than that, it's just the minimum. So that was the adjustment that was made there. The other two changes that were made were related to the site sizes. Site A, which was Portland Headlight South, was reduced from 90 feet to 50 square feet, or recommended, and then the other two were maintained at their same level, and then Site D, which is down at Ship Cove, was reduced from 90 square feet to 50 square feet. And those are the changes that we have that have been recommended at this point in time. I did receive one email from Donato Giovine. I hope I didn't mispronounce his last name, but he had requested to consider changing from 50 square feet to 70 square feet on Site D as a consideration for council. But these are the recommendations that we do have, and I think that's it. I know Bob and Mark are also here. They can provide some insights as well. And I know Councilor Straub was also on the park committee, and I'm sure he's intimately knowledgeable of this as well.
Would do councilors have any questions for Bob Malley or Mark Russell on this item?
Mm-hmm.
Kaylin?
I do. Sure. How did you land on 50 feet? Reducing it?
It's about the size of a hot dog stand as opposed to a trailer.
Mm-hmm.
Chris, correct me if I'm wrong. Most of this is about expanding the use. We're lowering the price of a couple of sites because we don't get bids on these sites. And about aesthetics. We don't want a big, huge food truck in the park. We restricted the size originally when these sites were opened up. And we think we got what we want. This was simply about trying to do the best of what we had.
What did you have in there for vendors this year? At which site?
Two. We had a vendor, Bite Into Maine, that I don't know the sites, but you know where it is. And then we had a gelato vendor down at the lighthouse.
Mm-hmm.
At one time, we had a hot dog stand down by the lighthouse as well, which was very well received. He did not bid after a year or so. And we've yet to receive bids on that site since that time. But we're willing, we want to be very careful about what we allow in the park for these types of vendors. Okay. Trailers vary in size dramatically, and something we've had quite a bit of discussion.
I've got a question. Has the committee ever talked about looking into, with these vendors, percentage of sales?
No.
There's not been any discussion about that? Okay.
There's been no committee level yep. discussion about this thing.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep.
Anyone else? Is there a motion?
Actually, I have one more question.
Okay.
Are there rules and limitations? Like, say I got, a hot dog cart, and I'm going to bid for the 50-square-foot one. Is there a set of rules that needs to be followed, like how many tables you have set up, how much area you have to take up for your cart versus your waiting, your queue line?
Yeah, we're conscious of traffic in the park. And one of the reasons we're proposing changing a site from a loop, the overlook loop that overlooks the beach, to actually putting a site down by the beach is traffic related. It's not just we want somebody to bid $2,000 for the site, we want to be conscious of traffic when we encourage somebody else to locate there. We're conscious of the traffic issues that Bite Into Maine creates, their own set of traffic issues. Too many people parking on the grass, people dropping people off and stopping traffic in the park. We're conscious of that. But we would provide tables for people. I mean, there are plenty of picnic tables in the park. But we're not going to, we're going to try to avoid congestion wherever we can. Park's crowded all the time in the summer. We want to encourage these kinds of things, but we don't want to encourage problems.
But there's no set of rules to follow.
Well,
that was my question.
I think there is. Yeah, we actually have, there's a number of permit conditions and requirements that someone has to meet. Everything from attire for the folks working, to what they can provide for generators, noise-related conditions. So we've had to enforce those in the past.
Mm-hmm. And so do you think by reducing the size of the site, you impact any of those other rules? I guess is what I was trying to get at.
I don't think so. I think, again, as Mark said, I think what we're trying to do is just look at the aesthetics of the program and, you know, trying to avoid having a food truck in some of the sites that it might not be as compatible as it is where there's topography that would shield the truck, so to speak, or a larger truck. I think our conditions and our requirements are pretty tight. And again, we've had to exercise them before with past permit holders.
One last question, probably back to Mark. Was there any discussion on the flip side of creating new locations for the bigger trucks? Like, if we want to get vendors in there, but we're not getting small vendors, could we create a new spot where we could incognito, mainly burgers or something?
Yes, there was discussion. We wanted to go in small steps.
Okay.
There are other locations that can be talked about. I think what we want to do is try to encourage these sites for very particular reasons, you know, geography and traffic, safety, and
see how it goes.
We succeed or not.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Questions for Mark? Thank you.
Well,
thank you. Okay, is there a motion? Or I should say, any more discussion? No? Is there a motion to approve the recommendations for vendor permit fees and concessions site size? Councilor Lennon?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Caitlin Jordan, any more discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous. Okay. Item 21, request from the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust for funds for Robinson Woods 3. I will ask the town manager to tee this up, please.
Point of order.
Yes, Councilor.
Myself and Councilor Lennon have potentially appearance conflicts with respect to this issue.
Would you repeat that, please?
Point of order, myself and Councilor Lennon have potentially appearance conflicts with respect to this item. Do I need to disclose, or do you want to disclose first? Or?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Councilor Lennon abuts the land that is being contemplated. The way that it's being phrased from the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust is that they're expanding the preserve to include this additional section of land. I believe abutting a section of land is a per se conflict. That's obviously my position on this issue. Both myself and Councilor Lennon are contributors to the land trust, and by virtue of that are in fact members of it and have voting positions in it. Neither of us are board members, but we both have contributed in the past. So I do recognize that it might create an appearance of a conflict by virtue of the fact that we as members of that entity, and it is a private entity, would be participating in a vote to expend a significant amount of money from the town's coffers and gift it to an entity that we are members of.
Well, Councilor Lennon?
I don't actually abut the proposed section.
The proposed new purchase.
I abut a section, but Robinson Woods 2, which has already been purchased and it's a done deal. This one is across the pond and over toward a neighborhood off the shore.
Yeah. Councilor Scott?
My point is that there's potentially an appearance. My understanding of the process is that even when it doesn't rise to a conflict, the point is the disclosure. It's the disclosure, it's the disclosure, it's the disclosure, it's the transparency. It needs to come out, is my understanding of the process, and then the vote occurs. You may say this doesn't rise to the level of a conflict. I totally understand that. My point is just the transparency and the disclosure. So, therefore, I raise it. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor, Jamie?
I would just add that I also have donated previously to the Land Trust. I don't know if I'm a current, I honestly don't even know if I'm a current member, if you call it that. I don't know. I've donated money to them before, so.
Yeah. Councillor Jordan?
Well, while we're disclosing, I've never given them money, but I support the Land Trust, and the Land Trust supports Cape Elizabeth Farms, so we are friendly with each other.
Well, I contributed to Land Trust years ago, but not for many years. I think at this point, now to think how to proceed, do you feel, Councillor Lennon, that you are at least at an arm's length and don't feel that you have any conflict? I'm trying to think how to proceed with this. I was just asking Councillor Lennon first. Are you comfortable deliberating and voting on this item?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you. Councillor Starr?
Point of order. My understanding of, and again, I wish the town attorney was here to give us guidance. My understanding of the way that our conflict rules are is if there's a question, if there is even an appearance, it isn't up to us to make that decision. It is up to the rest of you. We recuse. We don't technically recuse ourselves. We step aside and you vote. It is not up to us to say whether we think that we can make the right decision. Of course we think we can be impartial, but it's not our decision. It's yours.
Well, in that light, and considering what we did earlier this evening, then I would then ask other councillors their thoughts on this item. First Caitlin and then Valerie.
Just how we've done it in the past since the Code of Ethics rule came up with the disclosure is that you make the disclosure and then the council has that time to ask for your recusal, which is what we did at the beginning of this meeting. You made the disclosure that you were the subject of an item and then we asked for your recusal. That's how the vote works. We don't have to have a vote just to say that we hear your appearance. We're just clarifying that there could be an appearance to others from the outside, and then the council then has a moment to ask for a recusal. So there's been a disclosure, a disclosure, a disclosure, and a disclosure, and now we have a moment for any council member to ask for a recusal. It's how we have done it since we formed these lovely code of ethic rules that we did 2-3 years ago.
Well, then then to proceed along those lines, is any counselor interested in asking any of these other counselors to accuse themselves, if I'm correct in how that's going to proceed?
Makes sense.
Councillor Straw?
I disagree with the interpretation. Obviously, it's quite clear. Again, and just to be clear, I don't think you have an interest or a conflict of interest. I'm just looking for the disclosure. My understanding of the rules, I wish the town attorney was here to explain to us, is that you need to take a vote now. Obviously, you disagree, at least with respect to myself. I do request that you do a vote, because that's my understanding of how this applies, and I did just attest as to I understand the rules. And to me, I raise the issue, you vote. I'm not part of that vote,
so
and I do want that vote.
So, Councillor Starr, you're asking that we vote on what? Your recusal?
I have said that there is an appearance of a conflict. My understanding of the way that the rule works is I have raised the fact that there may be an appearance of a conflict. I step out of the picture, the rest of you then decide under the conflict of interest rule whether there is a conflict. That's my understanding of the rule. Obviously, we don't have the town attorney to give us guidance here. I could be wrong, but I would at least, my preferred avenue forward is that you just simply vote without me as to whether I have a conflict.
Councillor Lennon?
I would like to request / suggest that we have the attorney at our meet workshop on Thursday, because the way Chris is understanding this rule is
he's already there.
He's already scheduled.
Perfect. My second comment is we are not voting on this issue. We're not voting on anything about it, allocating any money or anything else. All we're doing is trying to put it to a workshop. In my opinion, when you're trying to put an item to a workshop or recommend something further, like a facilitated discussion, that is a different level. If we were voting on the final tally of allocating this money, yes, I would have probably thought to explain those things, but we're just trying to send it to a workshop. This is the beginning of a long conversation about this.
Well, Councilor Randall?
I agree with both Councilor Lennon and Councilor Straw that we do need these conflicts to come out, but maybe this isn't an issue for today, but when the actual issue of allocating those funds reaches a vote, we should discuss that. And I do agree that the way the rule reads is that we do have to vote at that time about whether there is a conflict, as it currently reads.
All right, Councilor Caitlin Jordan.
I was just going to say the same thing, that he is correct. Because he rose the issue that he has a potential appearance of a conflict, the way it is written, and it's probably why he wants it rewritten, but the way it is written, we have to take a vote. So definitely we need to take a vote because he rose the issue that he has an appearance of a conflict, and then we definitely need to revisit the exact language of how we're going to proceed in the future that these things do or do not require a vote. Sorry. What I said all about before was how we have done it in the past, but by raising the fact that he has an appearance of a conflict, and appearance is considered one of the three statutory conflicts of interest, it says that the remaining majority of the council will, the remaining members of the council will vote and proceed by the majority.
Dr. Garin?
So I think what Chris is actually referring to here is addressed in Section 5 of the Code of Ethics. And that's regarding appearance of conflict of interest. Am I correct, Chris?
Correct. Yes, thank you.
So it says, and I'm quoting here from it, to the extent any counselor believes that there is the appearance of a conflict, the best course of action is to disclose the facts and circumstances giving rise to the alleged conflict and to determine what, if any, steps should be taken to address it. I think it's pretty clearly outlined here. Mm-hmm. So
That's
Caitlin.
The confusing part is our code of ethics say one thing and our rules, which is what Chris brought up at the beginning of the meeting, say another. Mm-hmm. So if Chris wants to go by the rules, then we need to vote. If we want to go by our code of ethics, then we go by what I said earlier. And then at our next convenient workshop, we reconcile the two.
Councilor Straw.
Thank you.
Are we having fun yet?
So.
No, we're not really.
So at this point, what would you like to do?
My understanding of the rules, and this is again, as Caitlin Jordan noted, they need to be reconciled. There is inconsistencies here. I have attested that I understand these rules. The way that I understand them is that, and as it sounds like Caitlin Jordan and potentially Councillor Randall agree with me, technically a vote is necessary.
But you need to step away from the council first.
Yes.
Okay. Caitlin?
I move that we acknowledge that...
I'm sorry, point of order. We attested to the code of ethics. We tabled the rules. We're operating under the previous rules.
Which?
The attestation earlier was for the code of ethics. They're two separate issues. So
the rules still exist, though. We moved last year's rules over until we redo this year's rules.
Understood.
We made that motion.
As part of the oath sworn at the beginning of the meeting, I understand that both Councilors Randall and Straw agreed to uphold those rules. But the action taken earlier, I'm just making a point that the action taken earlier on item number 17 was an attestation about the Code of Ethics, so...
Right, but at the very beginning of the meeting, when Chris brought up the changes to the rules and we tabled it, we then made a motion to carry last year's rules forward until such new rules could be voted.
Agreed.
So we're operating now
under
those same old rules, which require that all I say is, I move that Chris has stated that he may have an appearance of a conflict, but that I feel he's able to continue moving forward and not request his recusal.
Mm-hmm. Is there a second? Councilor Lynn? Any other discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you.
So are we going to do this for each of the four people that...
I think it'd be safe to do that. It'd be the best procedure.
No, we just did it because he requested it.
Yeah, well, we also said it. So
they also disclosed. So I think we do need to do that for each individual council.
Who said it next?
Well, Chris called Sarah out, so I guess she's next.
Do I have to stand up and go away?
Yes.
Can I make the same motion and put Sarah's name in place of Chris's?
Yes. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? All right. And who's next?
I'll move that we insert Jamie's name in place of Sarah's from the previous motion.
Is there a second?
Seconded.
Any more for this?
Well, we need Sarah to vote on that. Or she can just...
Well, wait a minute.
You have four.
Sarah's got to come back from the bathroom.
We have a quorum.
Oh, good.
Is there a second? Was there a second?
I second.
Penny? Any other discussion? All those in favor?
Except you can't abstain from a vote. Sarah needs to be here to vote.
I'm sorry?
She's absent.
She was absent.
As long as you have a quorum, we can vote to take it.
Yeah.
Keep going.
Okay, and then could I have the same motion for Councilor Caitlin Jordan?
So moved.
All right, is there a second? Penny, any more discussion? All those in favor? Okay, all set there.
Penny has the same disclosure.
All right, so we've cleared all councilors. And so now all councilors can proceed with any discussion on sending item number 21 to a future workshop.
So moved.
Second that.
Okay, any more discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. All right, it was 6-0 with Councilor Lennon temporarily absent. Okay, item number 22, consideration of authorizing funds to enter an agreement with Good Group Decisions to moderate Paper Street's discussion. Again, if you would be so kind, Matt, to tee this.
Point of order, Madam Chair. As I iterated earlier, I believe I have an appearance and a potential conflict with respect to participation in any issue relating to Surfside Avenue, and I think that Councilor Lennon also has an appearance or a potential conflict with respect to participation in this item. I don't think that Councilor Garvin does, but I, again, nevertheless, so...
Well, so we'll proceed with the same exercise. If you feel you have a conflict, please take a seat in the audience, and we'll proceed as we just did.
In my understanding, point of order, or parliamentary question, my understanding is that the process is there needs to be disclosure of the various underlying facts with respect to this. Is that correct?
Well,
you can offer them.
Yes, you could offer. Apparently you can offer them.
As I covered earlier, I have personal relationships to the Rinaldis and the Reynolds. To the extent that you need me to go into greater detail with respect to either of those, I will. I have association relationship to Mr. Kalidi and Ms. Millett by virtue of my prior role with a political party in town. I have acquaintance relationships with a number of individuals in the area, the Murphys who I've gotten to know through the various issues that have arisen from here, but I only know them by virtue of this. Martha Palmer, who lives down there, the Inkers, and the Leopolds. And I can go into greater detail with respect to any of those to the extent that any of you wish me to.
Do you have any pecuniary financial relationships with any of these individuals?
So, and again, this goes to how I think there is perhaps a misunderstanding as to at least my understanding of how these rules work. My understanding of the rules, and again, we don't have a town attorney here to explain them, is that it doesn't need to be pecuniary. The pecuniary was how it used to be in the old world. We adopted a code of ethics that moved us into a new world. The pecuniary is no longer the test. The test is whether there is an appearance that in any way our... Again, I can't give you legal advice on any of this. Don't listen to this as anything other than... we need the town attorney to really weigh in on this issue and provide us some guidance on how this works. what can I say? My understanding of the situation is that I need to look at what's going on here. I need to say, do I have relationships to any individuals where I have interests because of those individuals in the issue? And then, once I have come up with a list of what my interests are, or what potential interests exist, I then need to say to myself, do those interests in any way lie in conflict with the town's interests? For example, the Rinaldis are attempting to sell their house right now. They have an interest in having closure in this issue, so that they can sell their house. It may not be in the town's best interest that there be immediate closure. It may be in the town's interest that this goes on for another 20 years. That right there is an example of two interests that are in conflict. My understanding is that you were told by a number of different individuals that this stretch of land is worth millions of dollars. If that is the case, if it is abandoned, that is going to have a multi-hundred-thousand-dollar impact on my friends, people that I consider my friends' property values, including one that is contemplating a transaction. That one, from an appearance perspective, clearly creates an appearance there may be a conflict of interest. Again, this is just my opinion, but I mean, you talk about not wanting us exposed to litigation. Can you imagine how this is going to play out? My God! For me, it is clearly an appearance of a conflict. Do I think I can be impartial? Absolutely. I think I am, in many ways, one of the most impartial people I know. I can put aside my emotions. I can clearly decide on this issue, but that's not my decision to make. It's your decisions to make. The people that don't have an issue need to step back. The people that do not have these conflicts then decide if we can participate. Okay. So, and I can cover additional conflicts that I have here as well. I can lay out my interests if you need.
I think we're good. Right. So if you would like to take a seat in the audience. And
do we need to cover Councilor Lennon's as well?
Well, I think we could do this one at a time. Like
right, fair enough.
Did.
Thank you.
Yes, please.
Yeah. Councilor Stewart, just one thing to consider before you turn too many chairs. One thing to consider, in the past, the conflict of interest question has been raised specifically to friendships within the community. And the advice that has traditionally been received has been related to, you're an elected official in a small town, and the chances are you were popularly elected, so you may know a number of people within the community. And within the role and responsibility of being a council member in any town or a selectman or what have you, you may have to make decisions that at some point may make your friends happy, but you may also make decisions that may at some point make your friends unhappy. The question that comes down to it is, a lot of times they look at consanguinity. You know, if they're a family member, if they're married to somebody maybe in your family or something along those lines, but more of a relationship than just friendship. In the past, folks have wanted to abstain from a vote because of the fact that they might make their friend upset because
they have to do a land. There may be a land
use, you know, language change that may take place that could either benefit them or not benefit them. They tried to abstain from that, but they've been told that they need to make a decision on that and they need to vote because that's by friendship level. You don't get a free pass to get out of being able to make that vote. So that's just one of those things where the reality of how folks need to do their job has kind of manifested itself. Do I think that a person could always state, or the argument could be, you could always find that there would be grounds to state that someone has a conflict of interest because they may go fishing with them, or they may be in Cub Scouts with them, or their wife may be the brownie leader for their daughter. There's a million and one different relationships. Ultimately, it comes down to if a person feels that it's important to them that they need to disclose that, and then the council can take a look at that, and then you can do it. But that comes down to, in many ways, and I think the council rules may even talk about this some, if a person feels that they may have a conflict, that they just need to disclose it, as you've said, multiple times over the night. So if, I don't know if that's helpful at all, but that's just something to consider.
Yeah, ask Kaylin.
I was going to say, I think we all get exactly what you're saying, but I think Chris is just getting hung up on the exact rules. And I think he could have done a better job at the start of the meeting articulating this problem that he found. I think he could have done a better job by writing to Matt ahead of time and saying, Matt, I think there's an issue, and maybe you should send an email out with some drafted language. And we could have had this conversation way back at the beginning of the meeting, and we would have been prepared to amend these rules back then. So I'm saying in a very nice way as I can, you handled this maybe not in the best manner. You could have preempted this all at the very beginning when you wanted to talk about this, instead of diving right in and jamming new language that nobody had seen. We could have preempted all of this. So right now we stand with Chris has said he has an appearance of a conflict. He needs to step aside. I'm going to make a motion that I've heard his disclosure that he has appearance of a conflict, and I think that we can proceed without having to have him recused. I'm looking for a second.
Second. All right. Any discussion? All those in favor? All right. Thank you. All right. And so we'll proceed with...
Wow.
Councilor Lennon, do you have...
I do not. I've been talking about this and voting on it and thinking about it for 5 years. If I'd had, I already would have. But under Matt's definition, I'm friendly with a few folks down there. I don't feel the need to. And furthermore, I would return to my former point that it's like sending it to a workshop. All we're trying to do is further the process to make everyone feel happier. I think that that's... I don't feel the need to list every friend I have there to send this to a group that would like to moderate some discussions, which I personally think is a good idea.
Councilor Straw.
First off, I am shocked. I am shocked that you just took that vote. And I look forward to having the town attorney explain these rules to us. I do want to read an exact quote from the code of ethics that we all just attested to tonight.
We discussed this on Thursday night.
Point of order, please call the member to order.
Excuse me. I think we just need to take a deep breath and a little bit here. And, you know, I think your points are well taken, Chris. I think that we are having a meeting with the town attorney soon, already scheduled. What I'd like to do at this point is try to move the meeting along. You've made your points very emphatically, and we're going to be taking a closer look at them. I think that you can bring those points up about our vote to the town attorney. And at this point, I'd like to entertain...
Madam Chair, I still had the floor. Point of order. May I continue with my quote?
Yes.
I just wanted to read this sentence from the conflict of interest. Okay. Quote, examples of conflict of interest include, but are not limited to, discussing, and voting on town ordinances, policies, or plans that directly or indirectly result in financial benefit to the councillor, personal friends, or the councillor's employer, provided the employer is not the town.
Kayla?
So I guess I'm confused, Chris. You just disclosed that you have the appearance of a conflict and then rambled on about telling us about it and then said, but I can proceed unbiasedly. I am the most unbiased. You said, I fully believe that I can proceed unbiasedly. So how is the council supposed to take your words if we're supposed to be registering whether you have an appearance of a conflict, and it's different between you having a conflict? You disclosing that you have a conflict or you have an appearance of a conflict, then you feel as though you can proceed. Because those were the words that came out of your mouth, that you are the most unbiased of biased people. I don't remember. I'm sure if we have it on film, we can play it back as to what exactly you said. But I just don't get what you wanted us to do, to vote to recuse you after you said that I just have an appearance, but I feel as though I'm unbiased.
Councilor Flynn, just...
May I just respectfully suggest that these are distractions from the topic at hand, and I would like to consider that we move along on our agenda, and I am happy on Thursday, and I welcome discussing this at as much length as we need to clarify it. But I think to bring this up over and over and over throughout this meeting when we have a long agenda is just not productive. we understand your point, Chris, and we're going to get to the bottom of it and clarify. Right now, all we're trying to do is hire a mediator.
So, Valerie?
I'll make one point before we move along. There are different rules with regard to actual conflicts and appearance of conflict, and I think that vote was, on my end at least, in regards to the appearance of a conflict, consistent with the code of ethics. But I would also say that with regard to this particular item on the agenda, I don't think necessarily it calls for an examination of the conflicts, but I do agree that that should be brought up at a later point.
Thank you. So I would like to move on. And so is there a motion?
Point of order, Madam Chair. I raised a potential conflict or the appearance of a conflict with respect to Councillor Lynn, and we do need to have a vote. And she still has yet to disclose the extent of her relationship to the Khalidi family.
I'm friendly with the Khalidis. I'm friendly with several other families in that neighborhood who are on both sides of this issue.
So
I don't believe that's been a full Chair.
I would have to say that at this point, from what I understand, and I can get help from the council, then what we should do is go through the exercise we've just gone through. If you are disputing Councillor Lennon's statement, then what I would ask Councillor Lennon to do is take a seat and the council can discuss your concern. So, Councillor Lennon, would you please? Thank you. So we've heard Councillor Lennon's thoughts, we've heard Councillor Strauss' thoughts. Is there a motion? Caitlin?
I move that I have heard and acknowledged Councillor Lennon's disclosure that she may have the appearance of friendliness with some of the members of Surfside and do not feel as though she needs to be recused from this. I also want to echo, aside from my motion, what Valerie said, that these conflict disclosures have nothing to do with the motion that we are discussing, which is the hiring of a mediator. They may have been needed to be disclosed before when we are dealing with actual paper street things, but right now the motion is just the hiring of a mediator, which these conflicts I don't feel as though are related to.
I take your point, but that is currently under dispute. So you've made a motion. Is there a second? Penny, any more discussion on Councillor Lennon?
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I don't believe Councillor Lennon has fully disclosed the extent of her relationship to the Khalidi family. I would like for her to give us the full details of their personal relationship. Or just simply admit, yes, there is a personal that the Khalidi family and your family are personal friends.
Am I allowed to talk
to you? I don't know. Honestly, I'm not sure that you are. I don't think that Councillor Lynn is allowed to engage in this, I don't really know.
Yeah, I'm in uncharted waters.
Okay.
Yeah,
Jane?
I think before she removed herself from the panel, that the words I heard is that she's friends with the Khalidis. Mm-hmm. Characterizing that as personal friendship or... I don't know what other kind of friendship there is, Chris. So, she said they're friends.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
One point of order may be that Councillor Strong may not be satisfied with Councillor Lennon's actions, but mm-hmm. if the other council members find that they have they're comfortable with that, and you can count to four, then I think you can move forward.
Yep. I think you're out of order, Councillor Strong.
My apologies, point of order.
We have a motion on the table. It's been seconded. And I did ask for discussion. You have given us your opinion that you do not accept Councillor Lynn's description of a friendship. You've made that clear. At this point, I'd like to call a question.
Point up then. Thank
you. All those in favor? And opposed? Okay. Thank you.
Chairman Sullivan, would you like me to tee up this?
Yes, please.
Oh, I was just going to make a motion so we could... I'm good. I read it all through. We're good.
I'll speak quickly. At the end of our discussion on Paper Street, at the end of the council discussion on Paper Streets last month, the council directed the manager to obtain a paid facilitator, or at least a proposal from a paid facilitator to assist in the discussion of the Surfside Avenue Atlantic Place issue. The thought is to have two sessions in 1 week, one midweek and one on a Saturday. And this session would be open to the entire community. Many people stated that this is, as many people stated, that this is a town-wide issue. A smaller committee making recommendations would find challenges that not being empowered as representative for all the interests would be challenging, as there are many different interests involved. I'm reminded of the Widow's Walk example that Attorney Parkinson discussed, and you find agreement with one property owner and move along and find disagreement with the next and the next and then finally agreement with another. So be concerned about having that with a smaller group. The goal for this session would be to identify areas of agreement, disagreement, and negotiable areas. It's getting late, I'm sorry. The desire would be that all interested parties would then come to at least one of the sessions so that all perspectives would be represented. I do have some. I have had some conversations and some concern because I have spoken with some parties involved in the discussion previously who have indicated that they are not interested in taking part in this type of forum or in other forms of attempts at mediation, which is concerning, but it's a challenge for this. This is concerning in contrast to the goal of having all interested parties represented. However, the desire would be to provide that venue where folks could have the opportunity to pursue that if they did want to. In preparing for the forums, Good Group Decisions would then like to hold a planning meeting to examine what you would like for the information and desired outcomes. The thought would then be to have a workshop with the entire council so that you may have the receive direction or provide direction to them from which questions can be formed and then assist in the forums to move the question forward. I have, as you saw in the proposal that we provided, they described all the actions that they were looking to take as far as how they would proceed. Also, I have secured a couple of different dates with them because the council also stated what their goal was to have deliverables ready for March. So I believe I have the first Wednesday in February and the following Saturday within that same week penciled in with them if council decides to go forward with that. And that's pretty much my full statement at this point.
Great, thank you. So any discussion on this? Caitlin?
I'll just make a motion that we approve authorizing Matt to hire, would you say, or enter into an agreement with Good Groups and have permission for the expense of $2,506 from our special committee's fund.
Is there a second? Penny? Any further discussion? I'd just like to thank Matt for spending a lot of time working with them and coming up with this. I think that, having several public forums at which the entire public is welcome is going to be a positive step forward. And anyway, thank you, Matt.
You're welcome.
So, I'm sorry. I'm very sorry. Yes. If anyone would like to speak on this issue, thank you for saying something. I completely
so
forgot.
Distracted.
Just please state your name and your address.
Sheila Mayberry, Trendy Road. I just have a comment about the definitions being used here because I think that there might be a little bit of confusion. Councilor Lennon said that she was glad that there was going to be a mediation. This is not a mediation the way that you're describing it. And I'm concerned that there might be some expectations attached to this that aren't a reality in what you're trying to do. So I think that you need to clarify what the purpose of the forum is and what it's not. And it's not a mediation. And if you want to talk about why it's not a mediation, I can go into it. But if there are stakeholders who are not voluntarily willing to come to the table and negotiate something in good faith and come out with a written agreement that is legally binding, then you don't have a mediation. I just wanted to point that out. This is something different. That's all I had to say.
Thank you.
I'd be happy to jump in.
No, that's an excellent point, and that's going to... We'll elaborate on that.
Yep. Thank you, Sheila. I appreciate that, the opportunity to clarify. What they're looking at is trying to have a moderated meeting where ultimately they can become familiar with a lot of the issues that we have there. They can provide structure in there, encourage participation among the people who do come that day, reflect the group's feelings and what they come forward with on the areas that they can agree on. Hopefully try to move the group forward. During the meetings, they'll try to find key findings, themes, and conclusions that can be documented and bring that forward so they can identify that so the council can then have that in addition to the work that you've done already. They do fairly a dynamic approach to it. I've seen this company in action before, where they will take the different concepts that come forward and kind of organize them and get them collated fairly quickly, and then provide a deliverable to the council, which will, you know, give a fairly nicely formatted, well-organized report, including major themes, conclusions, decisions if there were some that may have been arrived at, discussion comments, kind of paraphrased versus a transcript, and documentation of any next steps that may have been identified there. And to, as much as you can, have a list of participants who decide to sign in, show what the agenda was, what the ground rules that were established in the meeting were going to be, any kind of presentations or handouts that were appropriate, and a table of contents. So as far as bringing forward what the fruits of the discussion were going to be versus, as Sheila did say, I mean, a mediation is a whole different story where you've got folks who can commit to things, but we're looking to try to get people to yes, I guess, on a certain many different areas.
Well, and this is a gathering of information. There aren't going to be any decisions made. There's nothing binding. This is purely gathering information and thoughts and concepts that can come back to the council for consideration. So yes, your name and address, please.
Nicole McCarthy, 9 Salt Spray Lane, and I've spoken in the past and mostly focused my attention on support of the Surfside area of the streets. And after the last meeting, it kind of dawned on me I should be looking at a more broader view of it all. And I did write a letter, and I don't know how many of you saw it or not. And it really, two lights keeps getting being kind of pulled out, like we should view it separately. And it dawned on me we really shouldn't. And I'm glad that I believe, because it wasn't even mentioned in that last meeting, I think, that two lights wasn't going to be in this form, and is it now?
No, this would be Surfside in Atlantic Place.
I still would advocate that. I sent a lot of advocating that we don't keep pulling that out and voting on that separately, because I gave an example of, let's look at what happened at Pro Snack, and it was a Homer studio. It doesn't have to be an all or nothing. We can work through the forum, negotiating something that works for both sides. It doesn't have to be complete open access. It can be people park at the state park, and twice a day a van brings in people into that facility if we ever get it. But if we vote to get rid of that property, that possibility doesn't even exist. It doesn't have to just always be open to the public if we accept it. And I believe that's just one idea I have. I bet you there's a lot of people that have some really unique possibilities of how we could work with the neighbors, because I do think we have to work with the neighbors and shouldn't just dismiss them. But it is a very valuable resource to the public as well. And so I would request, again, that you do put some sort of discussion back into the two lights, and because that is one of the only possible access points in there. But it doesn't have to just be always open. It could be something like they did with ProSec.
Just the direction I received from council was to work on these two. The motion was.
I thought I saw at least an agenda, at least online. Oh. Two lights got added back in, so that's why I wanted to.
It's in there.
Sorry, it is.
Yes.
It already is valid.
Yeah. Okay. We can clarify that too, then that's no problem.
Right. Thank you.
What did you say?
I said, I'm happy to clarify
that.
I
believe is in them.
We can explore that with the folks.
Okay.
Name and address, please.
Yes, Deb Murphy, 24 Pilot Point Road. Thank you. I just wanted to, in item number one on the scope of the work, it's project planning, and it talks about a group of people, a small group, getting together in advance. Ideally, this planning meeting will occur with a small group of people who know the project and the desired outcomes. So I think, Matt, you were kind of, you were getting to some of those desired outcomes, but if the town council can be very clear on what the desired outcomes are, that would be great. And I agree with the previous speaker about Lighthouse Point. Thanks.
Thank you. So, where are we? Did we have our motion?
Yep. We're ready to vote.
And a second. We're ready to vote. Any other discussion?
Discussion. I just would like it to be known that I am uncomfortable with my participation in this issue, but my understanding of the rules is that I'm required to vote unless I've been recused for reason of a conflict, and although I think under the rules it's clear I meet the definition, I don't have the ability to recuse myself. And I was being facetious when I said, of course, I think. So I apologize. I'm going to avoid being facetious from now on. I realize that. I can't recuse myself. You said that I don't have a conflict, and therefore I am required to vote under the rules. So.
Okay. Councilor Jordan? Well, Caitlin?
I mean, you can't recuse yourself, but you can state to your fellow council members that you feel as though you have a conflict. And that's what you would say is, I feel as though I have a conflict, not there may appear to be a conflict to other people. So if you're saying you feel as though you have a conflict, then I certainly will make a motion that we should recuse Councillor Straw, that he has a conflict with the Surfside Avenue discussions.
Let's that just makes. Go this, and he can recuse himself on the bigger. But you know, I would recommend that we continue, and that Chris Straw vote on this item. I would recommend we just proceed. So, unless there's any other discussion, all those in favor? It's unanimous. Item number 23, appointments to boards and committees. The appointments committee, would the chairman of the appointments, well, actually, that just changed.
Yeah.
Well, Sarah's, what?
No, change.
Announcement. Yeah. Well, would one of the chairman like to present this item for us?
Could I think I have to do this before the item goes to the table too much. I mean, it's discussed too much. I'm serious about this. I need
so you're making a motion. Point of information or
I need to make a motion because I'm going to have to recuse myself. For I need my motion has to do with separating appointments for the planning board from all and do the others as a slate. And I need to recuse myself because of a conflict that, an apparent conflict,
okay.
Because before the planning board is an item regarding my property at 19 Wells Road.
So your first motion would be to take the planning board appointments as a separate item?
Yes.
Okay. Divide the question.
I'm sorry?
Divide the issue. Divide the item.
Divide the question. So, is there a motion to divide the question?
Well, I'll make a motion to appoint the proposed members to the Board of Assessment Review, the Community Services Committee, the Conservation Committee, the Firing Range Committee, the Fort Williams Park Committee, the Personnel Appeals Board, the Recycling Committee, the Riverside Cemetery Committee, the Thomas Memorial Library Committee, and the Zoning Board of Appeals.
Okay. Does that work? All right. Is there a second? Sarah?
And can I say, I just wanted to quickly thank for any citizens who are still watching all the great people who came out and applied to these positions. It's always a really lovely committee to serve on because you meet interesting people and they all want to serve and volunteer, and I think that's what makes our community great. And I want to thank them all. I want to apologize to the ones who we weren't able to find a spot for and say, please continue to be interested. Please apply next time. These spots do come up, so.
Okay, very good. Is there a second? Chris?
I'm, I do not favor approaching this as a block, and I would move to divide the question if we do take that approach.
Well, I think that's what Caitlin just...
I just divided it by pulling out the planning board.
She divided it by pulling out the people that are not planning board nominees. That should satisfy your concern.
I would like to... it could satisfy my concern if we begin with the planning board.
Well, we already have a motion to do the other, so could we vote on that and then go back to the planning board?
I would then move to divide the question. The issue is that two of the proposed appointments for two of the other boards, I would move that they be appointed to the planning board, thus the reason why this...
Okay. Could you please repeat that? I lost you.
It needs to be in the form of a motion, so I guess we have a pending motion, so...
You just want to have a discussion about appointing somebody else to one of the committees that I've voted to appoint. So during your discussion, make your case where you want to move whoever to the planning board.
Fair enough. Thank you. Yep.
So back with Caitlin's...
Seconded.
Okay. So with your original motion...
I think he's still confused. My motion,
I seconded it. Sorry. Now you're discussing.
So you want to have a discussion about appointing somebody else.
Yes.
So have the discussion.
Thank you.
But if you're interested in talking about other appointments to the planning board, Caitlin already divided that question, so we don't need to have that discussion until we talk about the planning board appointments.
Except I think he wants to appoint somebody who we're about to appoint to another committee.
Another committee.
So he needs to have the discussion and see if he's got support for it.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Except that Councilor Penny Jordan has indicated that she doesn't feel she can participate in the conversation because anything relating to the planning board would present a conflict for her.
Okay.
So whether it's in the context of this slate or whether it's in the context specifically of the planning board, it doesn't make a difference relative to that conflict.
She's
got the math right on.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry.
The question on the table is just the appointments
right.
to these committees. Chris would like to discuss alternatives to these committees. It has nothing to do with the planning board at this point. So
okay.
He needs to make a case for who he would like to put on to one of these other committees. It has nothing to do with the planning board. And then if we are convinced that we're going to take somebody else and put them on to one of these other committees, then we have an issue when we come to our next item, which will be the planning board, which Penny will need to step aside for.
So at this point, Penny, you don't need to go anywhere. At this point, you do not need to step down.
Right.
Because we're going to have a conversation only about committees, not the planning board committee. Sarah?
Okay. I'd just like to say, before you start, Chris, that we spent a good long time with these folks. We interviewed everyone. We spent two full evenings. We deliberated at length, and three of us, and our votes were unanimous, and I personally think that we have set forth a slate that's fitting for all these folks in the committees that they chose to apply for.
All right.
Not always their first choice, but to the best we could. Sometimes it was a second and third choice.
Okay. Chris?
I think this might be the best way forward. I would split the question to separately consider the appointment of Timothy Lunny to the Board of Zoning Appeals.
So would you please repeat that?
I divide the question to separately consider the appointment of Timothy Lunny to the Board of Zoning Appeals.
And can you spell the last name?
Lunney.
Lunney. All right.
I want him on the planning board.
I'm sorry, what?
The issue is I want him on the planning board.
So you are against voting for him on the Board of Zoning Appeals because you won't. Okay, I see. I'm sorry.
Yes.
I was looking at the other side of the page. Okay.
Call a question.
So that's your... all those in favor?
So I divided the question, so what are we voting on?
You wouldn't need to divide the question. You need to ask for an amendment to my motion to divide the question. And then you need a second for it, and then we would vote on it, and then we would go back to my motion.
Point of order, Madam Chair. My understanding of the rules is that to divide the question does not require a second or even a vote. It just occurs automatically under our rules. So I'm confused, obviously. I apologize.
It's already a motion on the table. I already made a motion including him, so you'd need to amend my motion, not divide my motion.
I move to amend the motion in order to remove discussion of the appointment of Timothy Lunny to the Board of Zoning Appeals.
Any discussion?
Second. Somebody needs
a
second.
You need a second. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor of removing Timothy Lunny from, as I understand it, from the Board of Zoning Appeals?
Point of order. It's not to remove him from the Board of Zoning Appeals. It's to remove him from this this particular vote. As in, he might be voted to the Board of Zoning Appeals after we have a further discussion.
Okay. All right, Valerie.
To clarify, the motion on the table is to approve the appointments for the Board of Assessment Review, Community Services Committee, Conservation Committee, Fire and Range Committee, Fort Williams Park Committee, Personnel Appeals Board, Recycling Committee, Riverside Cemetery Committee, Thomas Memorial Library Committee, and the Board of Zoning Appeals specifically for Kevin Just.
Yes.
Period.
Okay. No, the motion is for...
No, the amendment, she's saying.
Oh, the amendment. Yeah. Sorry, that's what we're talking about.
Okay. All right. All those in favor? We're ready to vote on that amendment to Caitlin's motion. And the amendment is to include everybody on all the committees. We're not using voting on the planning board, and we're going to only include
one
member of Board of Zoning Appeals, one nominee, and that's Kevin Just.
In this vote.
Okay. All those in favor?
Oh, this is just an amendment.
Right.
We're voting on the amendment.
Correct. We're voting on the amendment.
That's fine.
Okay, and so 6-1 with Sarah.
You didn't ask for a post. I'm sorry, did you ask for a post?
Well, I was just about to.
Oh, sorry.
I'm sorry.
Opposed.
Okay. Okay, so that amendment passed. So now...
We approve them.
We approve all those folks, except for the planning board members, and except for Timothy Lunny, Board of Zoning Appeals. So, do I need another motion for that?
Nope, we're good.
Okay, approving all those in favor.
We're just approving everybody.
You can vote on this.
Yeah.
I know, it's getting confusing.
Don't send me down a slippery slope. No, I'm serious.
No,
You're still okay. This is so serious.
Okay, so now we're getting to the point. Now we're at the point where you...
Now we would make a motion to approve the planning board members, which would tee up...
Yeah.
Your disclosure.
I move that Penny Jordan be recused from the next item, the decisioning on the recommended appointments to the planning board, and any discussion around the appointment of Timothy Lunny to Board of Zoning Appeals.
Is there a second? Oops, Sarah, any discussion?
And just to be clear, it's recusal due to a conflict of interest.
Yes.
Yeah. All right, thank you. All those in favor? Okay, it's 6-0. Okay.
I make a motion that we appoint the three members put forth to the planning board.
You can't have... Could you repeat that, Kate?
Well, it has...
You make a motion that...
Yeah, I move that we approve, is it Joseph, Peter, and John, Joseph Shallett, Peter Curry, and John Thibodeau to the planning board.
Is there a second?
Second.
Valerie, any discussion?
Madam Chair. So my issue at the end of the day is that, and I'm sure all of the planning board candidates are wonderful individuals, We have a policy for frequent turnover with board appointments. It's a stated policy in the town. There's supposed to be frequent turnover. Mr. Shillette, if he serves, if he's appointed, I believe this will be 3.5 terms that he will have served. I think it runs against the spirit of our policy. Mr. Curry, I think this will be 3 terms for... Yeah, it will be 3 terms for him as well. I find, again, that kind of runs contrary to the spirit of the policy of frequent turnover. Mr. Curry also served on the Town Center Committee. He may be a wonderful candidate. And then, most importantly, and this is what really causes me to consider the other candidate, who I will then discuss, is that Mr. Curry is also on the Comprehensive Plan Committee. The Comprehensive Plan Committee already has a liaison from the Planning Board. It's Ms. Valente. In effect, I assumed he had continued to remain on the Planning Board and on the Comprehensive Plan Committee at the same time by virtue of the fact that his term was expiring. I now see he's being proposed for reappointment. We are creating a situation where there are 2 effectively liaisons from the Planning Board on the Comprehensive Plan Committee, which also seems to run contrary to the spirit of the Comprehensive Plan Committee draft document. Now, it would be one thing if there wasn't a viable candidate out there to choose from instead. But ironically, the individual who apparently the appointment committee recognized as the character and the gravitas to serve on the Board of Zoning Appeals, Mr. Lunny, I looked at his resume, and he is the most overqualified person I've ever seen for one of our boards. He's a former town planner for the city of Bangor and has spent the last, I think it was something like between 40 to 50 years serving as in the capacity of town planning and town development and I believe he's also served on prior boards with respect to planning boards in other towns. I look at his resume and I say, my God, this guy, he is vastly more qualified than I ever would be to be on the planning board. And the fact that we do have this other candidate, I guess I don't understand why the interest of I'm sure Mr. Curry is wonderful, but I don't understand why the reappointment when we have this policy of frequent turnover, so we have new voices, new issues. Why is he being put forward when there is this other viable candidate out there?
Well, our policy is that we have 3-year staggered terms, and that's with all our committees. I mean, that's our town policy. I see no problem with that. One of the nice things about having people for a third term is that, you know, they're become very familiar with the issues that they deal with. I think I can tell you that I served on the appointments committee, and I'm, you know, very, very happy with the nominees that you see in front of you. Joseph Shillette, for example, is an architect. He's the only architect we have on the planning board, and architects are incredibly valuable on planning boards. So, you know, I think we have some outstanding candidates, and I would say that you know, Mr. Lunny obviously has wonderful qualifications, but, you know, I stand by the nominations that have been made, personally.
Could you touch on the dual planning board members on the Comprehensive Plan Committee?
I could, but I don't see that as really all that germane to what we're dealing with right now. I mean, you could perhaps bring that up later, but I think we can just proceed with our nominees for the appointments committee. And I'm not really sure about, you know, your reference to that. I don't recall that as being a criteria for his continuation, but in any case, I'd like to just stick with the matter at hand, which is making these appointments. So, Jamie.
I agree and disagree with Chris on 2 different points of this. Number one, I disagree about the frequent turnover in that I think that's a vague and subjective description, whereas the specific section of the boards and committees ordinance relating to term limits is pretty clearly spelled out about 3 consecutive terms without a break in membership. So I don't think that we can subjectively be saying, well, this position hasn't frequently turned over enough when it's well within the outlined language in the ordinance. I do do, however, remember discussion, because it was a contentious point, about having two planning board members on the Comprehensive Plan Committee. And it was my understanding, and I'm gathering incorrect understanding, that Mr. Curry was going to be concluding his final term on the planning board during the work of which it's a lengthy, you know, almost 24-month process for the comp plan. But that assuaged some of the concerns that people had about that dual role and dual appointment at the time, because he was, again, my understanding, going to be terming off. So it does give me pause to see that that is not in fact the case, and I think it validates some of the concerns that people had at that time.
Okay.
I don't want any of those comments to be misconstrued as my lack of appreciation for Mr. Curry's service on the planning board, of which I think he does an outstanding job, and I appreciate his volunteering for that, as well as the time that he's put in on the Comprehensive Plan Committee. But I do think it raises a question that should be considered.
Any other thoughts from other councils on that before I go back to Chris Feller?
I recall this as well, and I was wondering, did the Appointments Committee consider that?
We didn't have the conversation.
No,
we just had a graph of how many spots needed to be filled, and it was one on the planning board. We leave it to the town clerk to circle back to people who are already serving to ascertain whether they want another term or not. And so I, as chair, I don't get involved in those conversations. Tell me who wants to serve again. And I wasn't privy to the conversation about Mr. Curry when he was appointed to the Comprehensive Plan, because I think at that point I wasn't on the Appointments Committee. But anyway, I'm unclear what to do about that. I mean, I agree, you raise a good point, but I don't quite know what to do now since a year has elapsed. I guess that would be a conversation we should probably have with Mr. Curry.
Yeah, Chris?
2 points I did want to address. Number one, I actually interviewed for the Comprehensive Plan Committee and was told that I would have to step down from the Fort Williams Park Commission if I wanted to be appointed to the Comprehensive Plan Committee. Point number two, I don't think Mr. Curry needs to be removed from the Comprehensive Plan Committee. I'm just saying, and I echo everything Mr. Garvin said, or Councillor Garvin said, with respect to excellent service, whatnot. It goes to just the frequent turnover and the fact that people were previously told, if you want to be on this committee, you do need to step down. And I'm not saying he needs to step off the Comprehensive Plan Committee in any way, shape, or form. I'm saying we have another viable candidate that we can slot in order to alleviate these concerns.
I'd like to make a point of order of my own here. It is just after 10 o'clock, and we need a motion to suspend the council rules in order to continue past 10 o'clock. So I need that before we can.
The motion is only needed to take up new business after 10.
After the new item.
So after we finish this item. But.
Okay. All right. Okay, thanks. Sorry. Go ahead, Kim.
Sorry. You blocked it. The Appointments Committee, other than moving, Tim, from Zoning Board, which he seems very qualified to be on, to the Planning Board, were there other Planning Board applicants that would be qualified, or were there other applicants that applied for the Zoning Board if you moved Timothy up to the Planning Board? I mean, I'm trying to go through the applications here to see, but I didn't get to interview them, so I was looking for your,
Many.
Do we need
many people who wanted to be on the planning board?
We had a lot of applicants to the planning board. I mean, I would say not all of them were as qualified as others.
Mm-hmm.
I still am not clear. I mean, as Chris is saying, he's just bringing up the point. I don't think that precludes us. I mean, and what is the council thinking? Is this going to preclude us from replacing Peter Curry back on the planning board? Or, I don't personally see this
as a problem. I do now recall, because I, you know, I was thinking, what, you know, what was this? But yeah, what you have told me, Jamie, is you know, I'm remembering this. But, you know, in essence, you know, I don't see this necessarily as a problem, but I don't know what the council thinks.
I guess that's the question, the first question to answer. Mm-hmm. Is it a problem?
Is it a problem? Yeah, I don't know. What are councilors thinking? I don't know who was first.
Go ahead, Valerie. I think it's a problem. Particularly with the point that Chris brought up, that this other gentleman would be highly qualified, and where there is perhaps not a conflict, but there perhaps an appearance of a conflict. I think there is an issue with that.
What would the conflict be?
Well, it's not necessarily a conflict. I think it just creates the appearance of a conflict having the same person on the planning board and on the comprehensive plan committee. And the appearance of having then these two liaisons.
Well, there's only one official. That's
right. There's only one official, but then there's an unofficial one.
I mean, we have the, you know, the planning board is a standing committee. Comprehensive plan is an ad hoc committee. You know, we have situations where people are on a standing committee and also on an ad hoc committee. We don't allow people to serve on two standing committees. So, Caitlin?
I think if we were to vote that Peter can't be on both, most likely he'd be taken off the planning board committee, which isn't going to change anything that he contributes to the comprehensive plan committee. So I don't think it's necessary that he come off, because if you leave him on the planning board and you leave him on the comp plan, he's going to have the same input being on the comp plan. What he, being the planning board, it's going to have less of an impact bringing comprehensive plan stuff to the planning board, I think. Do you get what I mean? So I'm not seeing that there's a conflict. I'm saying, do you get what I mean? Like, the conflict would be that you have two planning board members on, the argument is that you'd have two planning board members on the comp plan, right? But you're going to leave him on the comp plan regardless, so you're not just going to switch off how he thinks from his time on the comp plan. His opinions will stay the same, so you're not going to gain a different perspective onto the comp plan, and he's not going to be able to bring the comp plan to the planning board, because the planning board is all about, it's a quasi-judicial. It's all about different. What the rules are and applying them. So I'm not seeing the conflict, okay. I guess, in my roundabout way of saying it.
It's not a conflict. It ran counter to the charter, which said, it laid out very clearly who would be there, and there was, I believe the town manager deliberately said there will only be one planning board member, mm-hmm. because there was a lot of debate around the former one, whether there were two or three. So it wasn't by mistake that he, and then everyone's like, why are there two planning board members? Well, I think that the appointments committee at the time had said, we're going to make him fill a citizen slot. But I think that they did that thinking that he would sort of become a citizen soon. So I agree with Chris. It is murky, and there was a dust-up about it, because you can't help but wear the hat of the committee that you served on all the time. You think through that lens. So I don't think it's fair tonight to vote him off the planning board, because I think we need to talk to him first and say, first of all, which would you rather be on? Do you want to stay on the planning board, get off the comp plan? Do you think both are okay? It almost seems like a conversation to be had at the comprehensive plan. So I'm a little bit befuddled about how to proceed, but I do think that we don't really have I think it would just be in very poor form for us to throw this person off the planning board that's been on it and clearly done a great job. So I think we either need to pause on these last few votes, or we need to forge ahead with what we recommended and have this conversation about Mr. Curry in our comprehensive plan. Committee. Jamie?
I agree that it's doing a disservice to Peter to make this decision fully on his behalf. If the council thinks that it's a problem to have him continue to serve in both capacities, then I think he should be given the opportunity to express his preference. It could be that he would prefer to stay on the planning board and step away from the comp plan committee, particularly given that the comp plan committee's work, while important, is in shorter term, shorter duration, in theory, than the 3 years that he'll continue feasibly to serve on the planning board. So if the council thinks that it's a problem to have him continue to serve in both capacities, then I think we should figure out a way to bring it up with him and vote on it separately.
I would like to weigh in. I don't think there's a problem having him serve on both. I really don't see what the problem with the conflict is. We have people on the comp plan that serve on other committees and boards, and we're not having that same discussion about them. You know, Victoria Valente is the liaison, and you know, as Caitlin was saying, the planning board is quasi-judicial. It's just very different. I don't think that there is anything about being on a planning board committee that is detrimental in any way to serving on a comp plan committee, and I don't understand the concern there. So I'm in favor of just voting him on, as you know, he's clearly would like to do. Jamie?
Well, I think the concern, I don't disagree around the credentials and the skills that he brings. Victoria Volant was appointed or selected by her fellow planning board members to represent them. She was not appointed by the council. Just as Ms. Hubbs from the school board was, you know, so we didn't have a voice in those selections. I think the concern is whether any one group is overrepresented, and I know that there are other concerns that have been brought up about underrepresentation of certain groups within town. My concern, if you even want to call it that, is just that something was represented to me one way when I made the decision that mm-hmm. turns out now to be, mm-hmm. you know, not a different. And so mm-hmm. that's what's okay. holding me up on this.
Okay. Well, I would just like to add before I take a couple other comments that, you know, the comp plan committee is 11 months into their work, and you know, I think that I'm certainly in favor of leaving things the way they are, only because they're 11 months into their work. And I don't want to get, I know we're having the discussion, I don't want to get too hung up on it. I you know, if the council is willing to go ahead and vote him on and then deal with the comp plan, vote him to continue on with the planning board and then deal with a comp plan issue later, or maybe have that conversation with him, but I don't know. Chris?
So I agree with you that I would prefer to leave him on the Comprehensive Plan Committee, but I also agree with Councillor Garvin, which the issue is the arbitrary, in case you can't tell, I'm big on rules, the arbitrary application of the rule as to who could be on the Comprehensive Planning Committee. There were representations made to me during the interview process that I could not remain on the Port Williams Park Commission if I wanted to. That was what was told to me. I understand that perhaps maybe I misheard. And I understand that the actual rule is two standing committees, but I was basically said, ooh, which do you want to be on? And I said I would like to stay on the Port Williams Park Commission. My issue is, as Councillor Garvin said, it does appear that if he was appointed under the understanding that he would be stepping off the planning board, it would be different if we didn't have another candidate available. Mr. Lunny's background is phenomenal as I look at him on paper. It isn't that Mr. Lunny isn't necessarily a viable candidate, because as demonstrated by the suggestion to appoint him to the ZBA, he apparently is. So I see a viable candidate there. I do have, it does give me pause. I think Mr. Curry, it has nothing to do with his qualifications. It's just the fact that there is a viable candidate out there, and we can put the rest of this to bed by simply going with the other viable candidate.
Sarah?
I'm just wondering procedurally, should we delay this final vote and have a conversation with Mr. Curry? I just feel like maybe I don't know what to do procedurally, but we need to keep moving.
Kayla?
I think procedurally we have to decide if the council agrees that he can serve on both. If he can't, then we should have a conversation, ask him which he wants. If we think, the majority think, that he can, then we proceed with appointments. We just need to call that question.
Thank you. Jamie?
The technical concern I have around the delay that occurs to me is the creation of a vacancy and the technical language about somebody being appointed to fill a vacancy. So I wonder whether or not the most appropriate action is to table the vote because it carries it over. But I honestly don't know if in doing so we would be inadvertently creating a different problem for ourselves by creating a vacancy that then a different set of rules apply to for reappointment.
Right. I think that's valid, and I certainly hope we don't go there. I would like to have a motion. I think that...
Point of order?
We have a motion.
I believe we have a motion. I may be mistaken.
I made a motion, I think, to appoint all of them to their respective boards. So either we agree that he should be on it and he can serve on both, that would win. That would be the motion.
Yeah. And Jamie?
I think the most appropriate thing actually tonight would be to move forward on the, with action on the motion on the table. Mm-hmm. Speak to Peter about this, and if we feel that there's a problem where he wants to make a decision one way or the other, he can always step down from either one, creating a vacancy that we would then address. But I think we'd be better served to move a slate forward, and I suspect that Chris is probably going to not vote in support of it, which I totally understand and respect. But I think in the interest of continuity of appointments, we should move a slate forward and then mm-hmm. try and address these other issues in a separate manner.
Thank you. Is there a second to Caitlin's motion?
We already seconded it.
Yeah.
We already have one. Okay. Any other discussion?
I just wanted to make one further point that we do have the power to remove him for cause shown at a later point, but perhaps in the interest of moving forward and not creating a vacancy at this point, we should approve
okay.
the appointment.
Okay. One moment, Chris.
At least vote on it.
Looking at the committee's charge, there is no prohibition against anybody serving on there. If you read the committee structure, it states that five of the citizens shall be appointed by the town council utilizing, and this is regarding the comprehensive plan committee, council utilizing its appointment committee process, which was utilized. And then it states that the town council shall appoint two members from among its members of the council. The school board shall, that school board and the planning board shall each nominate one of their members to serve, which both have done,
so but
the planning
the
board used appointed Ms. Millen. And then going forward, your committee shall elect its own chair and so on and so forth. And but there's no prohibition against that taking place on there. What may have taken place within the appointments process, I can't say, but I know that there specifically isn't, there's no language related to the, in the charter or in the charge. Just for folks to understand that, I've just been busy clicking away here trying to provide some.
Just very quickly, I think it's legal. In fact, I think I remember Patty was the appointments chair, and she asked Mike, and he said, yeah, it's legal. But it's Chris's appearance of, all of a sudden, it was like, why are there two planning board members? So it's maybe water under the bridge. It's just, I think that the appointments committee moved forward with that because they thought Peter would be good, which he is, thinking that he would not be a planning board member after a certain number of times. I think we should just deal with that issue separately. I'm agreeing with Jamie that we should move this slate forward, and then we should have a conversation with Peter Curry and perhaps our illustrious chair and clear this out and see what's people's pleasure. I mean, who knows what will happen. Deal with that.
So our motion on the table we have a motion to vote the three nominees for the planning board, Joseph Shalhoub, Peter Curry, and John Thibodeau, and that has been seconded. I'd like to call the question. All those in favor? Okay, thank you. And now we have to double back to...
Just a follow-up on that, so we're not moving to new business yet. I think it needs to be clear, though, we just voted him on to stay on the comprehensive plan, because we didn't touch that, and to put him on the planning board. But so a couple of people have said we need to have a conversation with him. I think it needs to be cleared up as to what that conversation is. I don't think we need a cleared up conversation, because we're not violating any rules. There hasn't been a violation to the charge. There's no violation to the thing. So going forward, I think he can be on both. You've stated going forward you think he can be on both. So what's the conversation that we're going to have? Pick one? Because that's not what I'm saying that he needs to do. So we need to know if there's a conversation going forward or not, because there was no conversation to go forward voted on. So I just want to make sure we're walking away from here clear as to what we're walking away with.
Jamie?
I don't think we're going to Peter to ask him to pick one. I think the idea was to have further and separate conversation around whether we think that there is a problem that needs to be addressed with the continued service on both. And if the council then thinks there is, then we go to Peter and say, hey, look, gotcha. We think there's a problem here. There's, you know, councilors that have, you know, reservations about your continued service on both. Some people thought that you were going to be terming off, that factored into their decision, etc. If it comes to the point where somebody's going to force a motion and force the issue to say, hey, I think he needs to be removed from one or the other, I'd like to have his input to say, okay, well, if that's the case, if push comes to shove, then this is what my preference would be.
Sounds good. I just wanted to be clear as to what our going forward was.
And with that,
Jamie?
I'd like to make a motion to temporarily suspend the rules for the purpose of continuing a new business.
I second that.
All those in favor?
Can I have a discussion?
Yes.
I think we should redouble our efforts to be disciplined in moving through our agenda so we don't have these very late nights, which is now, I think, the third council meeting in a row that we've done that. And I understand we had a full agenda, but I think if we know we can always suspend the rules are there for a reason. And if we're voting every single meeting to suspend the rules and go to 11, I think that we're perhaps doing something wrong. So I'm just putting a pitch in there for going forward. I think we should move with some alacrity if possible. I understand I talk more than anyone, so I'm guilty too, and I will redouble my efforts to keep my mouth shut, but I think our goal should be to get done by 10. All that being said, I will support it.
Well, thank you. All those in favor? Okay, it's unanimous. Okay. So the next item, I'm sorry, we have to go back to Mr. Yep, I'm sorry. So back to the Board of Zoning Appeals, and
I thought I voted all three.
We did do all three.
No, but we have to go back to Timothy on it for the ZBA.
Oh.
Because we pulled them.
That was the one.
We took them out.
Oh, I thought my motion was for all three of them. Sorry.
It was for the planning board.
Gotcha. No problem. Can I make another motion then?
I'm sorry?
Can I make another motion then?
Yes, please.
I move that we appoint Timothy Lenny to the Zoning Board of Appeals.
And that... Okay. Oh, yeah, we already appointed Kevin. Okay. And second?
Second.
And any discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous. Okay, item number 24, Caputa Club licenses. And my own point of order, I am a member of the Caputa Club. I feel that I can vote without conflict or bias.
Perfect. So you just got to step down. Yes. Jamie's got to step in.
Yep. Jamie's going to run the meeting while I'm gone.
My mother-in-law and father-in-law are both members.
Okay, so you step in and take chair to vote for her, and then she'll come back and we'll vote for you. Can I make a motion, Chairman Jamie?
Please.
I have heard Jessica's disclosure and feel that she can move forward on this motion, and there's no need for recusal.
Is there a second?
Second.
Penny, any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor?
Wonderful. Chairman Jessica. You're going to come back. Can I make another motion? I've heard Jamie's disclosure and feel that he can move forward, and there's no need for a recusal.
Second. All those in favor?
And then I need one.
Yes.
And maybe I can do a twofer. My family business does business with both the Caputa Club and the Bird Dog Roadhouse.
One at a time, please.
Caputa. My family does occasional business with the Caputa Club.
My understanding is I don't think that ever, commercial relationship, I don't think ever triggers any of the provisions, but I could be wrong. But
it's a, well, I don't know if it's a conflict of interest with their, I don't know, I'm just stating that there may be an appearance of a conflict that my family does occasional business with Papudik. We occasionally sell them lobsters, I think like 2 or 3 times a year.
Well, Chris?
But my understanding of the rules is just purely commercial relationship would not ever trigger one of those provisions, but so, but I understand. Yes.
The argument is that it would create an appearance.
Well, in that case, Councilor Jordan, if you're happy to step down and we can deliver.
I'm just trying to go with the craziness that's happening today.
All right. Thank you. Is there a motion? Go right. Do you have a motion, Sarah?
I was just going to move that Caitlin has, how do I phrase it? Caitlin has requested that we vote on her appearance of a conflict.
And that.
It doesn't require a recusal.
Okay, is there a second?
I will second that.
All those in favor? Okay, thank you. All right, I think we can proceed. Are we all set?
I was just going to make a motion.
Well, the manager of the Papudik Club is here, so if he'd like to say hello, if anyone has any questions. I also want to ask the town clerk a question, but
I can provide some information.
Okay.
But that would be helpful,
yep.
Madam Chair.
Thank you.
I spoke with the chief specifically related to Papudik Club's liquor license renewal, and he said they're an exemplary operation in town. No problems whatsoever.
Thank you. That's what I was going to ask the town clerk.
Thank you for that.
Okay. And any other further discussion, Caitlin?
No, I'm just going to make a motion to approve the mobile service bar, special amusement permits, and the malt, Unis, and spirits disc license.
Is there a second? Jamie, any more discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous. All right, item 25.
Thank you for your patience.
Seriously.
Item 25, Bird Dog Roadhouse license. And Matt, would you like to speak to this one as well?
I would like to say the same. The same can be said for the Bird Dog Roadhouse as well. No, there have been no citations and no problems noted whatsoever. Another exemplary operation per the chief.
Okay. Is there a motion, Caitlin?
Just to make sure that we're consistent throughout the day, there may appear to be an appearance of a conflict because my family business occasionally does business with Cape Hospitality Group, DBA, Bird Dog Roadhouse, and selling them lobsters a few times a year.
Well, then would you like to step down and could I have a motion? Sarah, you could repeat the motion you just made. It's the same situation.
Councilor Jordan has disclosed there might be an appearance of conflict of interest, but I would move that we not vote that she needs to recuse herself.
Is there a second?
Second.
Penny, all those in favor? It's unanimous. Well, 6-0. Okay, so back to the Bird Dog Roadhouse. Matt has stated that they are also in very good shape. All right. Is there a motion? Jamie?
Move that we approve their license as applied for.
Is there a second?
Second.
Penny, I saw her first. Any more discussion? All those in favor? And it's unanimous. Okay. Item number 26, acceptance of annual gifts and donations. Matt, if you could speak to this one as well.
Sure, I'd be happy to. This is an itemized listing of all the gifts that the town has received over the year, itemized by the different departments. And as you can see, there are some substantial ones, but we also, as you go down further in the list, there are others that are smaller varieties, but when we do receive them, we do need to acknowledge them on an annual basis, and this is an entire listing from everything that we do know received from all of our different departments. And I would also like to state on behalf of the town, thank you for your generous donations by so many different folks who make a lot of things happen within the community and allow us to do a lot of different things from their generosity.
Is there a motion on the table to accept these gifts and donations? Jamie?
I move that we accept the gifts and donations with extreme gratitude.
Is there a second? Second. All right, Sarah?
Discussion. Just quickly, can you explain why we have these penny donations? So I know what I'm voting on.
Yeah, to be honest, I think they just
Yeah, I can answer that. Been talking a little bit with a librarian. Came over one day with a lot of coin, and we got talking about how they accumulated all this coin. And apparently, when somebody goes to pay whatever it is they leave for the library, they won't want their change back, and so they'll keep it. And I felt it was important for that to be documented.
Yeah.
We're taking in money, even, and people say, oh, keep it as a donation. And I understand it's labor intensive for the library, but it's just important to keep track of the funds, so they are keeping track of it as we have requested. And again, that happens, I guess, quite a bit, you know, during the year. And I just thought it was important that, you know, we account for every penny.
Would be consistent with what our auditors would request us to do as well, because that way, as long as you catalog it and we can track point A to point B, it means that it doesn't travel out after point B to point unknown. So that way we can at least account for it, and that way we have a record. So.
Okay, well, thank you. Okay. So.
Call a question?
Yes. All those in favor? Thank you. It's unanimous. Okay. Item number 27, consideration of a standing renewable energy committee. This was sent to the ordinance committee for review. It's now back to us, and perhaps Caitlin or someone from ordinance would like to say something about this? Or?
Sure. I'm the only one left. We were, the town council sent the alternative energy committee's recommendation that we create a standing renewable energy committee. We incorporated into the town's ordinance that deals with boards and committees and have included it for you here. It's structured very similar in the exact same manner as all the other, how we restructured all the other boards and committees just last year.
I've got some thoughts on this committee myself. Does anyone have anything they want to talk about?
I have some thoughts also.
Great. Why don't you go ahead
at this point in time? I really think that the communication email from a Mr. Downs makes a lot of sense, that the objective of this committee needs to potentially be broadened and be more broadened yet more explicit and not use nebulous terms. Mm-hmm. And so I think that the work that the ordinance committee did was moved us in a direction, but I think what we may want to do is step back and look at the purpose and objectives of the committee.
Jamie?
I was just going to, I welcome your comments, but in the interest of time, I was just going to move that we refer it back to the ordinance committee. There's no urgency to this, and let's get it right and not fast at 10:30. So.
I'll second that.
I'd just like to say I agree. I have some other thoughts. I have a copy of Mr. Downs's. Pardon? I will. I've got a copy of his email. I thought he made some really great points that need to be considered carefully.
Mm-hmm.
I also have the thought of combining. You know, I'm not sure that we really need one more standing committee in town, and I was thinking that it might be worth discussing combining that with recycling committee as a recycling, sustainability, and energy efficiency committee, similar to what South Portland has. So, I would like to send it back to ordinance for some more study. So,
with that direction, perhaps.
Yes. You got it.
Awesome. Sounds good.
Have a motion yet?
Yeah, we do.
I did.
Has it been seconded?
Yep.
Yes, I did.
Okay. All those in favor? Thank you.
Nobody wanted to combine it with recycling before. I was talking about that forever. Nobody wanted that. You get the hammer, and all of a sudden, okay. Things happen, Jessica.
Well, you know.
All right, I see how it goes.
Cooking water. Moment changes everything. Okay, item number 28. I am tracking. Item number 28, request of the Harbors Committee to extend the deadline. Caitlin, would you like to tee this up for us again?
Yep, we're just about finished. We've compiled everything that we are to compile, and we're in the... like the home stretch, we're beginning to have our staff support. Steve Harding is generating the document that we're going to be editing and submitting to the council, hopefully within 3 months. Most likely, we'll be able to submit that within the extension, but we'll need to request perhaps another extension in order to finish that final charge that was added to our charge about assisting the Comprehensive Plan Committee, because the Comprehensive Plan Committee is just getting to the marine chapter and hasn't quite gotten there yet. So we want to write our report and then see what from that written report we can kind of take and apply. So we think hopefully we can get it done in both 3 months, but just want to give you the heads up that the one should definitely be done in the 3 months, and then depending on the comp plan's timeline, we might need a little more time to be able to help with their bit of it.
Thank you. Is there a motion?
I just have a question real quick.
Sure.
I assume the $5,000 is for Mr. Harding and Tobago Technics?
Yes, I can answer that.
Yeah.
After speaking with Steve about that, he felt that the original amount will be expended fully fairly soon. But this should get us, allow the committee to get to the finish line as far as generating the report and get them through the first 3 months or at least to that finish line. So that was his recommendation.
He's got a lot of work to do in the next 2 months.
Yeah.
Okay. Is there a motion?
Oh, I move that we approve the request of the Harbors Committee to extend the deadline.
And a second. Jamie? Any discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous. And finally, item 29, executive session, request for property tax abatement. We need a motion. It's recommended the council consider entering into executive session to discuss the request for a property tax abatement.
Parliamentary inquiry. We haven't received any training whatsoever with respect to the executive session. Could you just give us a quick, here's what we have to do? Or?
Yes, well, we have very specific reasons for which we enter into executive session, and that means the council, no members of the public can be present. One of those is a property tax abatement. There are several, but this is one of them. And so what we do is we have a motion that has to be read specifically as written, and we enter into executive session. We will deliberate on this property tax abatement request. Then we come back out of executive session and close our public meeting. So, Sarah?
I'm just wondering if a citizen wants to speak on an item that was not, or what, is there a time at the end? And do they have to wait till we finish this? I'm just wondering, you're just here.
It may be wise.
Because you have no benefit.
We could take, I'm fine with taking it out of order with council's permission. You know, to take that opportunity out of order instead of asking a citizen to wait until...
I don't know if he wants to speak, but here he is.
Yes. Yep. And if you just state your name and address, please.
Well, I was here earlier. Tim Thompson, I'm 6 Pioneer Road, and I'm the chair of the Comprehensive Plan Committee. I was here earlier. I had some concerns. We got through those concerns earlier in the evening. Went home to enjoy the Pats. By the way, they're losing. But then I was really in a panic because I was going back and forth between your continuing to follow your meeting and trying to follow the Pats. And
this is way more interesting than that.
The whole conversation about Peter Curry came up, and I was really in a panic. At one point, it sounded like you were going to maybe consider taking him off the Comprehensive Plan Committee. He's an invaluable member of our committee. We're 11 months into our work. We've got two great members of your town council representing the town council. It was clearly, Peter was clearly appointed to the Comprehensive Plan Committee as one of the citizens, the five citizens to be appointed. We've had people come off the committee. We have a young lawyer that had to come off. The Appointments Committee had to be reconvened and come up with another candidate to replace that person. Obviously, we're starting to, I think both town councils would agree, we're starting to gain some momentum at this point, get some of the work done that you want us to get done for the town council. And I just think the process, Councilor Straw was at our meeting the other night and objected about everything we've already done so far, which he's raised some legitimate objections, but at some point, we need to be able to continue to do our work. I think we have to show respect for your time, and certainly respect for my committee's time. And there were some things at the end of our meeting the other night that I really object to, and I wasn't going to bring this up tonight, but Councilor Straw, at the end of my meeting, confronted two of our members as they were leaving the parking lot, bringing one of them to tears. And I just think he described himself several different times that night as pedantic. And I guess I couldn't come up with a word that more accurately describes him. But I just would ask Councilor Straw to try, in what you're trying to learn your position here, to have some respect for the people that have been doing it for, in many respects, several terms. And certainly have some respect for the members of my committee, because one of them you brought to tears at the end of your conversation with her, and I think it's totally classless. And it's just something you just need to learn, some respect for your fellow citizens. Thanks.
Madam Chair.
Thank you.
Can I address that comment, please?
Yes.
I do not know what you're referring to. I did not engage in any conversations with any of your members in the parking lot after that meeting. I'm befuddled as to your statements. I don't know which members you're talking about. I'm at a loss. I don't know what to say.
Well, and I think I've used my 3 minutes, but I'd be happy to pursue that further with the town manager and Councilor Straw if that is necessary. All I'm asking is going forward, I don't want to see it happen again. And if we want to pursue it with the town manager and the town chair, I'd be happy to do that. I don't want to waste anybody else's time. Enough time has been wasted tonight.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. I'd like to leave it there and proceed on. So could I have a motion? Caitlin was first.
Yep. I move that we enter into executive session under 1 MRSA Section 405, Subsection 6F, to review the request of a property tax abatement.
For a second. All right, all those in favor? Okay. 10:40, we will move into the Jordan conference room from here.
Oh, I just want to grab my coat thing.